bespoke radio for the masses.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
If the game is rigged, change the game.
Game changer.
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
This is Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
I need your help to get to the year 1985.
You're listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
All right, welcome, Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today is Wednesday, February 17th. 48 days into the new year, 316 days left. Yeah, we are live from the bunker right here in downtown Burbank, California. And it's raining outside. We're dry in. More on that in a moment. I'd like to welcome everybody listening all around the world, all across the United States, hither and thither, to and fro, back and forth, up and down, east and west, north and south, far and near. This is Fade to Black. For KJCR, the Game Changer Network, and KGRA, the planet, I'm your also humble host, Jimmy Church. What is cracking, everybody? Hope you're in a great mood. Got a great show tonight. One that I've been looking forward to for a long time now. We pulled it off, as you know. That's right. Tonight, we have three very special guests. Steve and Dawn Hess are here. And author Ron Felber. For the first time on Fade to Black, all three to tell us about what really happened on that night in the Mojave Desert, back in 1989. The call-in number is 323-825-5045. Calls are lining up already. I haven't opened up the phone lines, and I'm not going to do that for a couple of hours. So everybody, just relax. All right. The call-in number is 323-825-5045. Tomorrow night is Fader Night. Open lines all night long. Favorite night of the week. Well, I can't really say that, can I, with tonight's show lined up? Man, excited. Now, right before the show tonight, you know, it's like 6:15, and, you know, our ritual, you know, we gather at the bunker, and we're all ready, and we brew that fresh pot of coffee, right? And the coffee grinder goes down. And I thought I could fix it, right? Okay, well, that lasted about 2 seconds. Anyway, so we had to go. It's raining. It's storming out here. You know what it is? It's Carmageddon out here in Burbank. It's insane. And we had to make the mad dash. Had to do it. There's no way the show would not. It would have been a replay. Oh, man. But we caught it in time. So, so let me tell you what we had to do. We had to go, and I didn't have the time to go to, like, a Starbucks or Pete's or whatever, you know, someplace cool, someplace with real coffee. We went to a place without real coffee, and we got the biggest coffee that they had. And I went and got, I had to think through this. So I went and got the, you know, the little mini cans of the Starbucks double shots, and we poured half of the coffee out and then filled it up with the... It's tolerable. And let me test it. Hold on. In a styrofoam cup. Oh, it's just blasphemous. It's breaking all the rules. All right, but we'll get through it. It's going to be just fine. So if you were listening to Coast over the weekend, I had Steve and Dawn Hess on. And it was a great show. For them to finally step forward after all of these years, to step forward, name changes, moving and everything, and trying to avoid the spotlight in all of this, they decided to come forward because they had listened to Ron and I a couple of times, Ron Felber and I a couple of times, have a great conversation about what happened out there in the Mojave. And so they decided, you know what, this church guy's cool. All right, let's go ahead and do this. So we chose Coast to Coast first, and then we knew that we could do Fade to Black right after that. And I want to thank them for going on Coast. That was a big step. I will actually do that in person when they come on the show tonight. But that's a big platform. You know, that's not baby steps. That is just going straight into the deep end of the pool on your first day taking swimming lessons, right? And I want to thank them for that. I thought that the show was great, and it wasn't difficult. It could have been. I mean, it's a lot of pressure, but we did it, and it was a great show. Now, but tonight it's Fade to Black. Tonight it's going to be a different vibe, and we're going to go there tonight. So please, everybody out there, get focused, get comfortable, do what you need to do to get it right. The studio is dark. Turn down your lights, get comfortable. It is going to be a great evening. I'm really looking forward to this, and so are they. And I did see in Twitter right before, you know, thank them for doing this. And you know what? I will. I will. Absolutely. All right. Now, also, let's get moving along here. Right this afternoon, I'm just going to do this. I'm going to throw Ronnie under the bus. Ronnie from Life Change Tea called me today, and he said, "How you feeling?" I said, "I'm feeling great, man. You know, Jimmy, I just want to thank you and thank all of the Fader Knots." And I said, "You know, Ronnie, honestly, I feel great." And he called just to see, you know, just to call and check in and say what's up. Ronnie's a great guy. He's got great products and a great company. And I thanked him up and down. And I told him about that story the other night on Monday when Rita tiptoed into the studio and stole a bunch of a bunch of pills. And I told him that story. And I said that because he asked about Rita, too. I said, you have to understand, it is the first time in my life I've ever stayed with and appreciated stuff like this, supplements. It's amazing. And I feel great. All right. Life Change Tea. Ronnie wanted me to thank all of you Fader Knots. They've been with us for a while now, and he's very appreciative of this audience. Help yourself, help the show, do it. Go to Life Change Tea. Do it. Start. I'm going to tell everybody right now, start with the tea, get the super strength, behave with it, start with the tea, do the cleanse, get through that. It's 3 days of bliss, trust me, and get through that. And then that tea, it tastes so good. You're going to drink it for the rest of your life. It's amazing. But start with the tea and then move on to the other products. It's amazing. Go and do it now. GetTheTea.com. Go to the banners at Jimmy Church Radio. Okay? All right. We have a lot of commercials on the show. I realize that, but commercials keep the lights on. This is a commercial station. This is what we do. And we have a lot of commercials. But there are two products, Life Change Tea and Studio Dome, that I use and stand by and will personally endorse. Studio Dome rocks. Ask any of the Fader Knots that were up at Big Bear, and they'll tell you Studio Dome is the real deal. Again, support the show. Go to Studio Dome. Get that surround sound system. It's $99. Go and do it. It sounds amazing. You'll be so happy that you did, and it's $99. Three Bluetooth speakers, a subwoofer, everything, wireless, hard shell cases, cables, power supply, everything that you need to get your situation right. Studio Dome. All right. Okay. Let's go. This weekend, it's happening. Yes. At the LAX Hilton, the 14th annual Conscious Life Expo, February 19th through the 22nd. ConsciousLifeExpo.com. If you can't be there, just go and click on the Get the Stream banners over at Jimmy Church Radio. Go and do that. Click Get the Stream. We will be broadcasting live Friday night. I've been announcing this every night. This is a big event. We're going to be in the main ballroom downstairs. Our guest that evening will be David Wilcock, Corey Good, Sean Stone, Dean Ryan, Linda Moulton Howe, William Henry, Mike Barra, Rosemarie Guiley, Laura Eisenhower, and Nick Jenkel, and Grant Cameron. It is going to be an extraordinary event. If you can't be there live and in person, which I understand, get the live stream. You will see Fade to Black in living color. On Saturday, I'll be hosting an Ancient Aliens panel presenting Linda Moulton Howe with her Lifetime Achievement Award. There's 104 speakers and panelists and free seminars all weekend long. It's insane. It's huge. It's an event. Tickets and info right now at ConsciousLifeExpo.com, or you can get the live stream. You can go to JimmyChurchRadio.com for that as well. George Norrie's going to be doing a game show. He's going to be hosting a panel himself. It's just an extraordinary weekend. Come and hang out with us. Now, also, right before the show tonight, I'm throwing them under the bus. I hope Mike Bear is listening. Michael Avon Oeming is going to be there. He's going to drive by with his wife on a Saturday night. He's going to come and hang out with us. You want to meet one of the great comic artists, one of the best illustrators out there? Where Rita and I are going to be Saturday night, Michael is going to be in tow. And I can't wait for him to meet Barra. So Michael Avon Oeming is going to be by. He's actually flying in from up north for a Comic-Con, which is going on all weekend down in Long Beach. So as soon as he's done doing his autograph session down there, he's going to come on up to the Conscious Life Expo. All right? Now, it's official, Michael. I just announced it. You have to be there. All right? Yeah, he's going to be there. All right. Let's do this. I'm excited. Fired up. It's going to be a great show tonight. So let's get it cracking. Today, Green Day frontman Billy Joe Armstrong, 44 years old. What's that guy worth? There's like 1,000 people under the bus, Jimmy. I know, right? Billy Joe Armstrong, Green Day. Somebody should look him up right now on Twitter. Follow us on Twitter, by the way, at J. George Radio. Look at Billy Joe Armstrong, like celebrity net worth, because that guy's got to be close to $1 billion. Billy Joe Armstrong, 44. Foo Fighters drummer, my good friend, Taylor Hawkins, is 44. Happy birthday, Taylor. Should call him on the break, see if I can get him on the phone. Renee Russo is 62. She will always make the cut because of Get Shorty. Follow us on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube. If you're at JimmyChurchRadio.com, just go click, follow, like, subscribe, do whatever you got to do. Tonight we have Steve and Dawn Hess. Ron Felber, the author of Mojave, the Mojave Incident, is with us. The call-in number is 323-825-5045. On this day in history, and it was a big one, 1966, Brian Wilson rolled tape on take one of Good Vibrations. That happened on February 17th, 1966. 6 months, four studios, and $50,000 later, he finally completed the 3.5-minute song. It was a symphony. Pieced it together from 90 hours of tape. Literally recorded hundreds of sessions. So the next time you hear Good Vibrations, think about what I just told you right now. He was a genius. And, oh, man, that album, Pet Sounds, right there, right? All right, Fader fact. Julius Caesar was pronounced Julius Caesar in ancient Rome. Yeah, Caesar, so say. Yeah. Do you hear the, are you with me? Are you with me? All right. I know you heard it today. Apple is opposing a judge's order to help the FBI break into the iPhone of one of the San Bernardino, California shooters called the directive, this is from Tim Cook, an overreach by the U.S. government. A public letter signed by the Apple CEO, Tim Cook, and published yesterday, warns that complying with the order would entail building a backdoor to the iPhone. And I'm quoting here from Tim. He says, it's something we consider too dangerous to create, end quote. Now, the letter starts off with this statement. The United States government has demanded that Apple take an unprecedented step which threatens the security of our customers. Remember that. We oppose this order, which has implications far beyond the legal case at hand. This moment calls for public discussion, and we want our customers, note that, and people around the country to understand what is at stake, end quote. Tim Cook went on to say, the government is asking Apple to hack our own users. Remember that. And undermine decades of security advancements that protect our customers, remember that, including tens of millions of American citizens, that we protect them from sophisticated hackers and cyber criminals, end quote. Now, stay with me on this for a second. Although Mr. Cook, as the head of Apple, he does have the right. He has the right to make decisions. And if standing defiant to a judge in a court order are one of them, he can do that. I have no problem with that. I don't. Especially when it comes to personal data and hackers. You have to make a stand. And I get that, Mr. Cook. I do. But this is where it gets a little strange for me. And understand what I'm saying here. First, Apple already has a crack for the software. Okay? There is no way that a team of code writers wrote software without a way in or around. I just don't buy it. And can you imagine this conversation? I was thinking about this today. Okay, we're ready. The encryption and software is so good that nobody, not even the NSA, the CIA, the FBI can crack it ever. No Russian hacker, not even us. We're good, man. It's ready. Let's go to market. I'm not buying it. If Apple admitted to having access, you know, the data itself, or the ability to crack the data, then every hacker without morals would be having at it. And I get that. So you can't say that there is a crack out there. You can't say that there's a backdoor. You can't say that it's crackable. You can't. Because if a hacker heard that, then you just turn around and tell them it can be done. And it will be done. That's all they need is that kind of motivation. I understand that. So Apple has to take that stance. They have to take the stance of, not even we can access the data. And I get that. And they should. Because the Apple customer doesn't need to freak out. And I get that too. I get it. I'm cool with that. But this is my second point. And this is where, like I said, nothing is ever what it seems, right? Ever. So you have to ask yourself, did the FBI ask for the crack so they could leave with it and use it willy-nilly whenever they want? That's important here. Or did the FBI want Apple to do it, have Apple in possession of the phone, and then return it after the data was pulled? That's also very important. The most important question after you ask those two is, if they wanted Apple to do it, then why does Tim Cook go public with this? Why have this go to court so it becomes public knowledge? It's a very strange situation. I don't quite understand it. To me, it just doesn't make any sense. But some things should be kept private. And if there's a discussion like that that goes down between Apple and the FBI, and you're at an impasse, figure it out. But don't take it public unless the FBI wanted to have the crack. Then you go public with it. Because if the FBI wanted to leave with the crack on a USB drive, then Cook did the right thing by going public and making sure that the courts got involved. I get that, because you don't want that crack out there. And you don't want the NSA and the FBI and the CIA and everybody else to have access to the back door of people's data. So I get that. So that's where this gets a little bit confusing, and it doesn't make a lot of sense. If the FBI wanted Apple to do it at Apple, then that stays private. If the FBI wanted to, if they were asking for the software and they were asking for the crack and they wanted to leave with it, then you go public. You scream. But there are certain things that need to be kept private, certainly with something like this, dealing with terrorism and everything else. But there's a third thing that I found confusing. Tim Cook is calling the San Bernardino killers customers. And I don't think he thought through this, because they're not customers. They're dead shooter, murder killers that killed 14 people. So they're no longer customers, right? They're dead felons. That's what they are. But I'll leave that up to you to formulate your own opinion on that. It just sounds and feels a little funky to me to make that statement, to treat them as customers, because there's an exception to the rule. Feels a little funky, Mr. Cook, and I respect you. Fourth, and the most important point to make in all of this, if Tim Cook was kidnapped, right? The CEO of Apple, if he was kidnapped and the criminals left behind an iPhone, it would be cracked before you could say, what is my iTunes password? And I promise you that. Man, strange. We're going to see this play out. We're not going to see the end of this just yet. I just want you to think, things are never, ever what they seem. All right. Let's get to all the news that you know nothing about. I got a few things I want to do real quick before I get the Hesses in here. Anonymous. Anonymous has posted online a document that provides a checklist on how hacktivists can carry out and expose their own operations with the same style as the famous group. It covers everything from where to submit hack data, how to start a protest, and what to do to begin your own anonymous operation. I swear, this is so great. So great. And if you go to our Facebook page, jimmychurchradio.com, the point-by-point list is right there. Go check it out. It's pretty cool. You got to love it. In preparation for the launch of NASA's new astronaut-carrying CST-100 Starliner next year, the U.S. Space Agency has been testing the spaceship's crash-landing capabilities by dropping it into water. We have the pictures. The commercial craft, a collaboration between Boeing and NASA, is expected to boost American space travel by facilitating regular visits from the United States to the International Space Station. That's right. We're back in the space business. Once operational, the spaceship will be able to carry up to 4 crew members, along with 220 pounds of pressurized cargo. And it looks like it's going to kick off in 2017. The Starliner is expected to make at least 2 trips a year to the International Space Station. And when I posted that today, Dan, I think it was Dan from Australia, or Mark Tarana from Australia, one of our Australian brothers, posted on Facebook, dude, we've been doing this for 60 years and we're still dropping stuff in the water. And they're absolutely right. I made a little correction to it. And when I said It's been 40 years, but yeah, 40 years later, we're back dropping stuff in the water. It doesn't seem like we've made much progress, does it? But it's interesting. We're back in the space business. Now, check this out. An amazing story. A team of Pakistani researchers, they've unearthed what they believe to be a 1.1 million-year-old stegodon tusk in the central province of, my favorite, Punjab. Yeah, Rita just spun around. Punjab. Stegodonts, distant cousins of modern elephants, are thought to have been present on Earth from around 11 million years ago until the late Pleistocene period, which lasted until the end of the last ice age, around 11,700 years ago. Now listen to this. The tusk measures over 8 feet in length and 8 feet and is 8 inches in diameter. The thing is 8 feet. You should see the picture. Go to jimmychurchradio.com on Facebook. We got it right there. All right, one last thing. I got to do this, and please don't hate me. All right? Don't kill the messenger. Everybody knows that Kanye West has announced on Twitter that he is $53 million in debt, which he blames on his clothing line, by the way. And we immediately throw all of it into the nobody cares column. I get that. But one has to ask, are the Illuminati done with you, brother? Are you a canceled check? Or the bigger question, why can't you get a loan from your wife? Right? Isn't that just a simple check? Just write that out, 53 mil. Here you go, honey. Sorry about that. You know, or seriously, the bigger question, why am I even talking about this? Well, it's because it's really, really funny. Karma is a bitch. There's rumors around of Kanye losing it backstage at the Grammys. Yes. And a few minutes ago, the audio has surfaced. So tomorrow night on Fader Night, it's not going to be an exclusive by then. I could have done it now. I didn't have the time. But we're going to play Kanye West backstage at the Grammys. And you're going to love this. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Fade to Black. Tonight, Steve and Dawn Hess are here. Ron Felber, author of the Mojave Incident, is going to be here to make sure that I behave, keep things in line. This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Network and KGRA, the planet. I'll be back. It's a rainy day here in Burbank. It's all good. Be right back.
You're listening to Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Fade to Black will now pause for alien identification.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National Tax Experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. It doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously. Give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444. Or go check out their website, www.nattax.com. NATTAXExperts.com. That's NATTAXExperts.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
Okay, nurse, let's get this man to the ER stat.
Right away, doctor.
We see this every day. Heart attack or angina pain due to blocked and clogged arteries. Chelation can remove obstructions or blockages from arteries and help avoid painful and expensive surgery. Now there's Angioprim. It's a liquid oral chelation product that you take with juice. You start to feel the results fast. Angioprim increases blood flow all over the body, and that means more energy and strength to take on the day with less aches and pains. 60 years of research has gone into chelation. And Angioprim is the result, a safe and easy way to unblock your veins and arteries from buildup that slow circulation.
Paging Dr. Jones, please report to the emergency room right away.
Log on now for a special radio offer from Angioprim. That's angioprim.com/radio. A-N-G-I-O-P-R-I-M. Angioprim.com/radio or call 877-882-7221. That's 877-882-7221.
9 out of 10 geneticists agree.
Fade to Black is not your father's radio show. On the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the planet.
Hi, this is Chase Kletsky with Fate Magazine Radio, and you're listening to Jimmy Church and Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA digital broadcast station, where the Fader Knots rock.
Hi, this is Rob Reiner from Anvil, and you're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? I'm Chris.
What up? This is Combat,
and you're listening to Jimmy Church Radio.
All right, welcome back to Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Network and KGRA, the planet. Let's do this. Are you ready? In 1989, Steve and Dawn Hess headed out to the Mojave Desert, anticipating a quiet camping trip. But when they were kidnapped by what they believed to be a swarm of alien beings, the shock and pain of the experience change their lives forever. And tonight, author Ron Felber joined Steve and Dawn Hess for the first time on Fade to Black, following Ron's appearance when the incident was first revealed here and over at Coast to Coast. And tonight, they'll be discussing their nightmare that began when they spied hundreds of shiny objects flashing signals to one another in the nighttime sky. Here we go. Hey, guys, everybody there? Check one, check two.
We're here.
I'm here.
Ron?
How you doing, Jimmy?
All right. You guys ready to do this? Listen, before we get started, let me say this. Thank you for coming forward. Let's do that first. That's a big step. And you took the biggest of steps on Saturday on Coast to Coast. And that was that had to have been heavy and difficult, but you guys did great. All right. So now that you've got that behind you, do you guys feel the pressure off just a little bit? Are you guys okay today?
Pressure's not off, Jimmy. It's like opening new wounds, and it feels a little oozy.
And it should, and it should, and it should always feel that way, actually. But, you know, for somebody to decide to come forward and try to figure out how to do it, you were very fortunate in that Ron and I, you know, have a relationship, and there was an opportunity there to, you know what, if you're going to do it, don't play around, you know.
Right.
let's just do this right. And we did, and we pulled it off. Now, I've had tons and tons and tons of feedback from the show, all of it great. And so that's where, you know, when you wonder, I wonder what they're telling Jimmy. I wonder what the network said. I wonder what, you know, I wonder what his producers are thinking. You know, well, look, it was all good. Everything's cool. you know, so let's just relax it a little bit. Now, tonight it's Fade to Black, and I get to play hardball. So let's go, you know. This is my party, so.
And, sounds good, Jimmy.
You know, again, thank you so much. All right, now, before we go and jump into this, because tonight I think I want to, we're going to go over all of the details, and the audience definitely wants to hear from you and hear your side of things. And, I mean, Ron already presented the correct side, but, you know, hearing the little details from you guys, and we're going to do that. But I want to clarify a couple of things really quick for the audience, because there have been some emails from people that are a little confused on a couple of things. So let's just, like, set the record straight. There are two versions of the book, two sets of names. Originally, you ran with, in the first edition of the book, you used your original names. Second book, fake names, right? Fake names. No other way to put it. Why did you choose to change your names in the second book? Was that Ron's decision, or was that yours?
It was Ron's decision.
And
I'll tell you, Jimmy, it was just about privacy, at least from my side. I knew that there was some uncomfort. And this book was really resurrected. I mean, this was a very odd situation in that it was rediscovered, and after, you know, a period of years, and just took off like wildfire. But it didn't take off like wildfire at all when it first came out. And maybe it says something about the public these days, that they're more ready for a story like this. But no, that was, you know, we used pseudonyms for privacy. And I never, frankly, we published, I think, 1,000 copies of the book to start. So it was really, you know, the publisher was looking at it as sort of a minor book, but it's turned into something much different than that.
Well, and for the public, you know, when they hear two versions of the story and two sets of names, they wonder if it is the same, two different stories that are similar. Right, because
no.
They hear two different...
I'll clear that up right now. That's very easy to clear up. Because really what I did was change a little bit of the epilogue and a little bit of the prologue. But the story itself is identical.
Yeah. And I've read both versions, and I understand that. You know, like I said, the audience is like, didn't I hear about this, you know, years ago? But it was a different couple. Is it the same story? It feels similar. These are different names, and
sure.
Is it the same story? So that's what I want to do. I want to set the record straight. The names were changed, not necessarily to hide something. It was just to protect Steve and Dawn.
Yeah, it was about privacy. That's the way I looked at it.
Right. And okay, so when excuse me, that's the second cough I've done live ever and couldn't hit the cough button in time. I apologize for that. When the book first came out, Steve and Dawn, when the book first came out, did you tell anybody about it, or did you just kind of let the book do its own thing and you didn't really surface or walk around and tell anybody that that was you?
Yeah, you're talking about the original book?
Yeah, the original book.
Yeah, I mean, really, if we can just back up just a little bit, really when we started this project with Ron, I mean, this was before the internet, you know, it was 1990, and so we didn't know him, and we didn't know of his works or his talents or anything, and honestly, we wanted it recorded for posterity, just our thoughts organized, but... honestly, I don't think we ever even thought it would be published.
Right. And then it did. And
then it got published. And then we had to rethink things.
That was my point. So then you guys decided to leave Southern California, right?
Oh, it had nothing to do with... leaving Southern California had nothing to do with the book. That was purely a job opportunity.
Oh, see, and the reason why I want to discuss that is because most people would think, I would, this is how I would look at it, that you guys are moving to another state, another city, now you're running low key, and, you know, you just wanted this to kind of, but it was just merely a job opportunity. That's all it was.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. And, you know, and it's an important thing for the audience to understand your background and what is actually going on here. Because when you look at all the pieces to the puzzle, it's just like, wow, you know, but that's actually what happened. And that's how that's how you guys dealt with it. So.
Right.
Okay.
We did decide not to. We decided once it was published, unfortunately for Ron, we just were not emotionally ready to promote it in a, you know, media kind of a way.
Right.
That was, we were not ready for that.
Now, this is what I want to do for the audience that has not heard your story before and the audience that has. This is it in a nutshell. I'm going to give you the 15 to 30 second events. This is how it went down. Steve and Dawn went up to the Mojave Desert. They were there camping. They had an encounter. They had an abduction. First, second, third, fourth close encounter. And then went back home, started to look into and discuss this. Their lives had obviously changed on a personal level for both of them. Steve with his job. Dawn went into investigating previous UFOs and UFO history, which neither of them knew much about at all at that time. But then we're introduced to Ron. We'll discuss that. Ron then in turn took them to Washington, D.C., where they met with a doctor, and we'll discuss that, but met with a doctor who then referred them to a regression therapist in South Carolina. They went there, were regressed independently and then together. And then the parts of the story that they did remember and then the parts of the story that they didn't remember started to come together. Ron was a witness to all of that stuff in Washington, D.C. and in South Carolina, documented everything, put it together, and then released the book. And so tonight, there's three or four different stages to all of the events. And tonight, we're going to discuss all of those stages in detail. Okay? Are you guys ready?
We're ready.
Okay.
Ready as we always are.
Yeah, right. Thank you for that, Steve. Steve in the background. Here he is. Let's kind of start here because... let's start here in Southern California, and let's start with the day that you left in your truck, and let's kind of start there. What was the mood of the day? And at that point, was there any indication at all about what was about to happen 12 or 14 hours later? Did anything seem out of place?
I'd like to take that, Jimmy, and just basically say, not at all. Certainly, I was anticipating a great trip where I've been up to the desert several times, grew up out there, very familiar with it, and matter of fact, was very excited about getting to go out on this trip, and actually more excited to have Dawn included to come with me and agree to come with me. I know her idea of a camping trip or a vacation wouldn't exactly involve out in the back of the desert in a camper, probably more closer to around a pool or a beach and kicking her feet up and relaxing a bit. So I was kind of thrilled with both things because it's something that was very dear to my heart, that I grew up out there in the area and was very outdoors and enjoyed hunting and camping out there and had did that many previous times with my family, which, you know, I had probably some of the best memories and experiences of my life out there. So I was very excited, and so it was a great mood, and certainly no anticipation of anything happening besides enjoying myself like I always had.
And Dawn, for you, were you into camping? I mean, I shouldn't say most, but certainly the city-bound women like my wife, she will never, you know, ever pitch a tent.
Yeah, not really the rough-out camping like we were going to do. Right. I would be happy in a motorhome, but, you know, I was happy. I knew it meant a lot to Steve, and you know, we had a toddler and a baby, and any getaway at that point was kind of a treat. So, you know, I was looking forward to it.
And so when you start off like that, Steve wants to make sure that his wife has got all the creature comforts, right? You can't have your wife complain. So he's there, and he's doing the husband things. And all the husbands out there are like, Jimmy, shut up, man. You're giving away our secrets right now. But it's really true. You know, we want to make sure that our wife is comfortable and happy and everything else, because if anything hiccups, you're going to have a rough trip, right? And that's really the truth. So
that is the truth.
That's it. So you guys hit the road. Dawn is cool because in the back, she knows all of her creature comforts are there, right? For the most part. Yeah, you're going to be able to get through the weekend, and you're supporting each other. You're married. It's all good. And you head off on the freeway up to the Mojave Desert.
Yep.
Okay.
It's a trek. We were in LA County at the time, and so it was a trek up there.
It is. It's a bit of a distance. You know, from here in Burbank, it's not too bad. You know, you can get there pretty quickly. But you guys are heading out from Orange County, so you can tack on a couple extra hours. But it's the Mojave Desert is local to anybody in Southern California. It's part of our lifestyle here.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you guys take off. And let's get straight to the campsite. You get to the campsite, which is, what was it called?
The Mid-Hills Campground.
Mid-Hills Campground. And, you pull in. Dawn, were you happy with what you were seeing at that point?
Well, I mean, it's not the kind of campground with all the fun showers and pools. It's very primitive, but you know, I was expecting that. That was okay.
Okay, so you're dealing with it, but the campground appears to be full.
It is full.
Appearance not, Jimmy. I've never seen it like this in my entire life that I've been up there. But for some reason that weekend, it was completely full. They have two loops in the campground, a lower and an upper. And there wasn't a spot one available.
And there's a reason why. You guys know why I'm asking these questions like I am, because I know what's about to happen. But the audience doesn't. I need them to understand exactly what's going on. All right? Steve wants to make his wife happy, that wants to stay in a Hilton hotel. And there is no Hilton hotel. You guys are roughing it. You're going to a campground that doesn't have showers and pools and all of that fun stuff and a store and everything. Campground of America, if you will. That's not what. And so you don't even get that.
Mm-mm.
Right. And now
right.
The campground is full. And then poor Steve has got to pull something. And that's what he does. And he takes you another 5, 6, 7 miles away from this last bastion of humanity and takes you further out into the desert to a spot that every husband says these famous words. Well, I know a place, right?
Right.
And that's what happens, right?
Yes. I'm calling it, plan B. As a good husband, being prepared, you always got to have plan B in your pocket.
Right.
And, certainly this is plan B, and it's a good backup plan, not the perfect plan, but it certainly, I think, led to an interesting evening, to say the least.
Well, Steve, that's your story, and you're sticking to it, and I can appreciate that. But you're going out to the middle of nothing, and you do that. So 7 miles in the desert away from the last campground and human beings is a long ways. I mean, you can't yell for help, right?
We're not even on roads. This is rough terrain.
Yes.
It's very bumpy thing.
Right. And for some reason, he's got his spot, and you guys go out, you park, and start to make dinner. Is that what kind of night was it at that point?
Well, I'm going to back up just a tiny bit, Jimmy, because it's not like I wasn't having my say as he's driving to heaven knows where in that desert. I'm like, I think we better just turn around and go back, go to state line.
Of course.
You know, and
of course you are. Yeah.
I tried. I tried to talk him out of it.
Yeah, it's still not too late to turn around, Steve.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. wasn't there a Motel 6 back there off the freeway? So you get out and you find your spot that Steve wants to go to, and you start unpacking your stuff. And as you look around at this point, everything is still pretty much normal, right?
Oh, yeah.
Normal, beautiful night, and set up the camp spot. And you got to visualize we had a Ford F-150 truck with a camper shell with the carpet kit in the back and the bed across the back, and had all the supplies packed. So I let down the tailgate and got everything laid out, got the campfire set up, and got our chairs out, and got the stove and our ice chest, and started to prepare to make this what I thought was going to be a great dinner, and have a few steaks by the fire, and enjoy the nice, crisp air and all the beautiful stars that we'd be able to see.
Now, Dawn, I know what you did. You looked around to see what you could see. How isolated were you? Was there any lights out there? Was there any houses a couple miles away?
We were right at the foot of Tabletop Mountain, which is part of the New York mountain range. And so in one side of, the truck and camp, there's a mountain. And then as far as I could see, it's just the horizon of an empty desert. For as far as we could see.
What kind of feeling does that give you, that kind of isolation? Does it make you a little bit nervous? I mean, because you are truly alone.
Right. No, that's what I was vocalizing as he was going out there, was that, anything could happen to us out there and no one would even find us, And I know, and he kind of laughs really now, because I'm like, there could be a motorcycle gang out there who could come and attack us. And he's like laughing. He's just like, I think you would, be more likely to find a motorcycle gang getting you in L.A. than here. But nonetheless, that just voices my real vulnerability I felt out there.
Yeah, because if something was going to happen, you can't yell for help. I mean, it would take an hour for somebody to get out there to you, even if you could make that kind of contact.
Right. There was no cell phone back then.
No cell phone.
Right. And then you guys finish dinner. Everything is good. Now we're going to be heading to a break in a few short minutes here, and this is a perfect time to do this. Steve, you finish your dinner, you're by the campfire, you turn your back to Dawn, and you see something. Tell the audience what happened.
I'll back up just a little bit earlier. So exactly what was happening is I was actually still cooking dinner and preparing dinner, and I was looking into the back of the truck and facing the mountain range in front of me, and Dawn was sitting with looking at me, looking up towards Tabletop Mountain. And at one moment, I was just glanced above the top of the camper to the top of the mountain, and I saw this white, single, shining light right above the horizon. And once I saw it, it saw me, like we were looking at each other, and I felt it rather than saw it. Both kind of sensations that someone's looking at me. When I locked onto it, it quickly just dropped right behind the mountain and disappeared. And I tried to play it off, but I know Dawn caught a glimpse of my face, and in the back of my mind, I'm not going to bring that up just after all these thoughts she's already had about being out here in the desert.
Right.
And then we finished our dinner and tried to enjoy it and just kind of brush it off, because at that point nothing happened.
And that was for long. Yeah. And this is a curious moment here, because you're trying to, like I said, you're trying to make your wife happy, comfortable, and she's out in the middle of the desert, and you suddenly have this sighting. You know what you've seen. You've had this experience before as a child. So you had this thing in the back of your mind. You know what you saw, and there's no way that you can hide it. And Dawn, how was Steve's mood changed? Did you notice anything at that point?
Well, I could see the distress on his face. And so, of course, I'm sitting up going, what? And he's like, oh, you know, nothing, just relax. And even though he said that, you know, I knew him well enough to know
he was
something's
lying.
Not yeah. quite right.
Right. And I just said you knew he was lying, right?
Yeah, of course.
But it's true. It's true. That's what happens when you are married. And right. and I'm not going to make light of it. It's just the way life is. And so now, Steve, how are you trying to handle it? Because was it constantly going through your mind? You're trying to hold a conversation with Dawn, but meanwhile, you're thinking about what you just saw. Were you trying to make sense of it?
Well, definitely was, Jimmy, because the biggest thing that happened to me is when I saw it that moment, and kind of like you alluded to earlier, it was an instant flashback to the time that I had seen a similar object when I was at Lake Mojave camping with my family. And it hit me like a bolt of lightning that I knew with a surety exactly what it was.
And
I had no doubts, but it was definitely in the back of my mind trying to say, I see what I saw, and I knew what I felt. So it was very, very riveting, to say the least.
Did the did anything change physically around there at that point? I'm referring to the noises of the desert and other things, or was the climate still the same?
Definitely was still the same. Nothing had changed there, and like I said, You know, it doesn't happen, this event, and that's one thing I will say, it was an event. It wasn't a, you know, quick see it, now it's gone. This is an ordeal that lasted hours and hours. But the beginning of it, when I initially saw it, till other things started happening, there was probably a good half hour, 45 minutes before anything changed.
Yeah, at this point, you guys are feeding the animals, everything is cool, there's... The nightlife in the desert is there, and everything seemed like it was still okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes, indeed. We're enjoying the fire and watching the kangaroo rats scurry around and tossing them some breadcrumbs and hearing the desert alive like it always is at night and enjoying hearing the sounds of being out in nature.
Okay.
It was very good.
And I have to ask, Don, was Steve like darting from left to right? Like, did I see something? Was he?
No, I think he was trying to, make light conversation. I mean, I felt like something was wrong, but I wouldn't have thought. I didn't think anything was that wrong.
Right. So
we were still, able to enjoy the fire and have conversation. And I just thought, okay.
Now, we're going to be hitting a break here in 45 seconds. How much time elapsed from this little normal period to the objects in the sky that started to form patterns? How much time elapsed there? Because we'll pick up after the break.
I would say it was about half an hour to 45 minutes after I initially saw it until after we had finished our dinner and kind of enjoyed the campsite. Then some other things appeared.
Okay.
Got a little spree.
And we'll pick that up right after the break. Tonight, Steve and Dawn Hess are here. Author Ron Felber is standing by to make sure that I behave. This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. Tonight, it's the Mojave Incident live right here on Fade to Black. I'll be back right after this short break. Stay with us.
Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Hakimi, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Hi, this is Ray Sobbs here, repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black. On the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
People love to shop. What if you could shop and it was actually good for you? What if you could actually purchase items that bettered your life? What goes into your body is important to what quality of life you have. How about shopping for items that better your health? GetTheTea.com is that shopping place. We're not only tea, even though that's our number one seller, we are about helping your health. There's colostrum LD for those of you with autoimmune troubles. The product helps your stomach get on track. GI problems produce pain. Get relief with colostrum from LD. How about some fat burners? Or maybe some joint aid? Or a power cleanse? There's so much to tell you with very little time. So get help health-wise at GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Or you can call our friendly operators at 928-308-0408. That's 928-308-0408. Get help and relief by going shopping. Shop at GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Serving people with great products for over 8 years. GetTheTea.com.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you, and your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers. Well, the...
yes.
We are of the Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
Hello, Fader Knots. Are you looking for the ultimate Bluetooth speaker system? Well, check this out. The Studio Dome Surround Sound System, featuring the Studio Dome 1 SD1 and the Studio Boombox SBB wireless Bluetooth speakers, is the perfect way to get surround sound without all of the cable headaches. With its own hard shell custom carrying case for taking your surround sound experience on the go. Each hard shell case comes packed with an SBB, two SD1s, cables, and power. It's just $99, and you use the promo code Jimmy and you get yourself some free shipping. Once again, Studio Dome brings you the best deal on the net. Anywhere. Just go to the Studio Dome banner, JimmyChurchRadio.com. Promo code Jimmy. Go Beckley Tappy.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black. Across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
Welcome back, Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. The Spoke Radio for the masses. On the Game Changer Network and KGRA, the planet. In 1989, Steve and Dawn Hess headed out to the Mojave Desert, anticipating a quiet camping trip without showers. But when they were kidnapped by what they believed to be a swarm of alien beings, things changed. And tonight, we're doing the Mojave Incident live with their author, Ron Felber. All right, guys, let's pick up right there at the moment. Oh, somebody just tweeted, did he say kangaroos? No, he said kangaroo. Yeah, no. Kangaroo rats. A big difference. You know what? If my daughters saw pictures of these, I would have a kangaroo rat here at the house.
Stephen Dunn, you'd have to be feeding the kangaroos your full steaks. Never mind the thumb.
Yeah, right? No kidding. Okay.
You know what? I don't like rodents, but those little kangaroo rats are really cute. They kind of have little puppy dog eyes.
Yeah. Until they start procreating. And right. Yeah. So, okay, now, about 30 minutes goes by of relative
happiness, bliss. You finished your steaks. Everything is good. Steve is aiming to really please at this point. He's hiding what he had just saw. He's doing his small talk. I'm recapping for the audience. He's doing his dance. He's doing his husband dance. He doesn't want to freak his wife out, doesn't want to freak Dawn out, because if he would have just said, and by the way, honey, then you guys would have packed up and left. But that didn't happen. And so he's, you know, doing his thing. And then about 30 minutes later, who sees the objects in the sky first?
I did.
And what did you see? What did you see, Dawn?
Well, we were just sitting there, you know, we're looking at the vast sky full of stars. I mean, if you've never been in the desert, you can't imagine without any light pollution at all how many stars you can see.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a very clear night. So, you know, we're just looking at the stars, having small talk. When something catches my eye, and I noticed that there's like a cluster of stars that seem to be connected somehow and shiny. And I said, what is that? And Steve's like, oh, that's like probably a weather balloon. And so I'm looking at it, very skeptical. But I'm looking at it, and I noticed that, you know, it's not like sparkly like glitter. It's little lights that seem to be blinking in some kind of organized pattern. So I'm like, I don't think weather balloons can blink like that. And why are there so many of them? You know, and so
how many do you think you saw at that point, Dawn?
I think that cluster was like if you had, you know, like a nice bouquet of balloons, probably between 12 and 20, all just clustered together, like a cluster of grapes. And then as you look closer and you're straining your eyes thinking, what exactly am I seeing? It almost took on appearance of like, then you could see there was form around the blinking lights, you know, maybe a little, the only material we knew to reference was like mylar, something shiny, translucent. And I'm like, those are not weather balloons.
How far away do you think they were at that point?
Well, I would say still when we initially saw them and Dawn had pointed them out, and of course that was the exact same direction that I was already previously looking, so I wasn't too shocked, but I was shocked. But it kind of rushed up on the horizon. I would say that we're probably a half a mile away from them at that initial point.
Very close.
Very close.
Half a mile in the desert is next door, no doubt.
Yeah, and I mean, they came up behind the mountain where they rose up to. And again, they were, you know, you look at a star, you can see a bright star. They were bigger than what a star would be when you're looking into the sky. And they were much brighter. And again, blinking in kind of a distinct pattern. And that's when we saw them almost disperse a little bit. They formed almost what it looked to be to us as a giant M formation in the sky. They looked like they were kind of all tethered together at that point, or at least seemed to be organized that way.
And yeah, when you say, really, that's interesting when you describe it as an M as you would read it, a right side up M.
Mm-hmm. Like a capital M.
A capital M. And are they blinking? Oh, before I get to that, I've never asked you this before. Ron, did you at this point admit to Dawn that you had seen something earlier? Did you man up?
No, actually. Oh, you're talking to me?
I meant to say yes. Steve. Steve, at this point, yeah. Did you man up and admit that you had seen something 30 minutes prior?
Heck no.
At that point, not no.
Okay,
nah,
all right.
Not
fair
to
enough.
It, so
fair enough. Point. I wouldn't have either, by the way. Okay, all right. Fair enough. Okay, so now the pattern that is blinking, is it communication? Does it look like you know, are you seeing one blink and the other blink in response? Is it like that, or is it a pattern that is on display? You know, like Christmas
lights. Not like
lights.
A mathematical pattern where it's like that one, then that one, and that one. No, we didn't see a pattern. We just saw that.
They seemed to be communicating.
Yeah, it just seemed to be communicating.
And do you think, and I don't think this was brought out in the book, and, you know, that's Ron's fault, but did you think that, did you think that they were speaking to you?
No.
Well, I have to say, I'll answer that differently. I thought somewhat yes, because of the feelings I had prior and the feeling I had with it when it was kind of blinking. But in the sense when it first started, I thought they were more communicating with each other, because it wasn't shortly after they had formed this position like they did. They dispersed themselves all the way out through the valley. It was almost like they were on a string as they spread out fairly evenly across the whole entire valley.
And I've always visualized this. So when they strung out, were you in the middle of the string? You know, as you looked up, were you in the middle, or is it a string that went away from you?
They were a little bit more to the west initially, but then they came right over the top of us.
Right. And how much space, Steve, do you think was in between each craft?
Well, looking at that valley and judging the distance, I mean, it's a vast valley. You know, it's probably, you know, 4 or 5 miles across, and I'd say they were probably a half a mile to a mile apart when they dispersed across.
Wow, interesting.
And you could see it from, like I said, the west horizon all the way over to the east horizon. Now they were spread out in this valley.
Dramatic.
Yeah, dramatic.
Dramatic.
Well, that's when you first realize, okay, this is something intelligent and decisive. So that's scary.
Did you think that possibly at this point it could be the military, it could be the Air Force, it could be NASA, it could be JPL, it could be something secret, something terrestrial with an explanation? Mm-hmm. Did you guys have this conversation or think about that at that moment?
Absolutely.
Yeah, we definitely did. I know my thoughts exactly, knowing the proximity to Nellis Air Force Base, Area 51, all those areas that are out there, and, you know, Edwards Air Force Base is also out there in the desert. It seemed like it was kind of more organized and military precision, kind of the way they spread out, but the way that they moved was nothing that I knew of that could move that pace and just kind of freeze and float and do what they wanted to do at the time.
Was it illuminating the desert floor, or were the lights too far up?
Not at this time. Oh. And certainly they were too far up. And kind of, you know, once this happened and once they dispersed across the desert, that's kind of when the next phase of this experience started happening. Because once they were in position, this is when we next saw almost like Mylar balloons dropping out of the sky all over the entire desert, just floating down.
And did they, this is such a critical moment about setting up for the evening. Did they appear to be coming from those lights, or were they just appearing on their own?
Seemed that there were so many of them that they just appeared on their own, but they just started dropping out of the sky, and everywhere you looked in the sky, you could see it dropping out.
And you've described this as thousands, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. And when I picture this, I mean, was it almost like when you say thousands, it must have been overwhelming. So like sparkler? I mean, just like out of control thousands. I mean, just like a parade, you know, confetti. You know,
like an army.
Yes, yes, yes.
Jimmy, one of the words we used for the chapter heading was onslaught.
Onslaught.
Yeah.
It must have been incredible. And just an army of these things dropping down. And what happens next with these objects?
Well, we're still watching them, only assuming that, you know, it's of human nature. It wouldn't be, you know, realistic to think anything otherwise. So I'm saying, oh my gosh, it's the Russians. You know, I'm thinking all the Russian army is parachuting down into our desert to come invade the United States. That was my initial thought.
Fair enough.
Because they're gliding down like on parachutes. I can't see parachutes, but you know, that would, you know, be reasonable.
Right. And they were floating. This was slow.
Yeah. They were floating down. And so, of course, you know, you think, oh, those are humans. That must be parachutes. You know, they're coming down and, you know, invading. And sure, of course, and we're in the middle of the desert. That's great. and so that's when I'm starting to freak out, thinking, oh, no, we're going to be captured by the Russians.
Now, if I'm Steve, and I kind of know what happens here, but if I'm Steve, I'm arming up at this point. You know, I'm freaking out. And Steve, what did you do?
Well, that was exactly my reaction. I went into the protective husband mode, and certainly one of my thoughts, well, maybe they didn't see us, so I quickly tried to douse the campfire, kicked it out, and threw dirt on it and covered it up and basically extinguished it. So maybe they didn't see us. But at that time, once they started hitting the ground, we've seen another change that took place, and the fact that these objects that were floating down all of a sudden took on a different form, and these red eye pairs throughout the valley, and as soon as they started hitting the ground, they seemed to be starting to advance toward us. So obviously at that point in time, I did grab my shotgun, I did grab my rifle, and I did grab my vest with all my ammo in it, and basically told Don, you know, the only thing we have here is our camper. You're in a covered wagon out of nowhere. Time to jump inside. That's about the only protection that we had. And encouraged her to get in the back of the truck as quickly as possible.
Now, okay, so as you're looking out, you have a panoramic view of the desert floor, and you have the mountain off to one side. Are mm-hmm. all of these red eyes pointing at you?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. And were they encircling you, or were they coming at you from just one side?
Well, I'd say it would be more one-sided coming directly at us, because if you can picture, the truck was parked facing the mountains. We had the mountain to our back. And as we looked out to the north, we had the entire valley. We could look from west to east, the whole panoramic view. And it seemed like the whole valley was full, but they were coming directly at our location.
And how spread out were they, Steve? Are we talking about a half mile, a mile? You know, we're talking about thousands of these creatures. You know,
I would say initially when they landed out, they were a mile out, but they rapidly started advancing across there. And obviously, where I knew that there's no roads, and there's, you know, the canyons and crevices and hills and rocks and things to come over, they just seem to be at ground level, but coming straight towards us, advancing, you know, not like exactly sprinting, but coming at a fairly good pace. It was fairly rapid. Like, it wouldn't take them long to get there, but, you know, we maybe had mere minutes to get in the back of the truck before they got to our location.
And how much time do you think you had?
I think it was probably less than a minute by the time we finally did and get into the truck. And as we got into the truck, I lifted up the tailgate, shut it, but the back of the camper shell we left open so we could see out what was happening. I didn't see, I don't know why I didn't try to close that at all, but you know, we were sitting in the camper at this point, kind of in an Indian position with our backs against the bed, and we were probably a foot or two from the tailgate, as far as we can get into the truck.
Okay, so let me visualize this for a second. The tailgate is open. The window's open. Tailgate's up. You guys are out the back. You've got your gun and yeah. guns. You've got a vest with shells and ammo. And as you are looking, so when you're looking out the back of the open camper shell, you are looking directly at the convergence of the red-eyed creatures that are coming at you. Is that what's going on?
That is absolutely correct. That is exactly where we were and how we felt.
I can't imagine anything more creepy or terrifying than that. And there's nothing that you guys can do.
Nope. Nowhere to go.
You had to wait it out.
Yep.
What happened to the desert? What happened to the noise? What happened to the kangaroo rats?
Well, I think, it was right during this time that we had spotted these initial objects in the sky. Things seemed to change where there was an eerie silence throughout the valley. There was no more chirping, no more scurrying of the rats. They almost like they disappeared. They went in their burrows or whatever they were doing, but there was no sound or no one was out, and it got eerily silent.
And here they come, and now they've arrived at your truck. And what do you see?
Initially, when we saw them and encountered them, they were about 3 foot in height, very impish looking or elfish looking, kind of with small childish like bodies, but with red eyes. But they seemed to be almost maybe smallish monkey looking. Type, but they were very active in the fact that they almost were trying to intimidate us or scare us, running around, screwing around, jumping on the bushes, jumping around and over the truck, and it was terrifying is what it was at the time. I didn't know what to think. I know I had initial thoughts of that I was going to shoot them, but I think some things had changed at that time.
I have a question, Steve.
Yeah.
If you did shoot them, if you took a shot at them, what do you think would happen? Would it go through them like they were a hologram? Would it hit a solid object? What do you think would happen?
Well, they look like they actually had physical form, so I would think that it would have entered them. But when that was happening and my thoughts were going to that range, I think that's when we experienced another phase of this whole thing, and this is where two what we call the sentinels appear, and guards, as it were, kind of just appeared at the back of our truck, probably about 4 feet outside the back. These two dwarfish objects that were very stout in stature, kind of seemed to have form, but maybe not as much form as the other things that we had saw, maybe more holographic, but it almost seemed like they were able to put thoughts in my mind at that time and basically told me trying to shoot them or to do anything would just cause us more issues and problems, that nothing could hurt them or harm them, and that I should just put the gun down and forget about it because you told them to try.
Did you put your gun down?
I did, and I think Don felt that same thought process as well. I think we felt it together.
Don, you made, sorry to interrupt you, Steve. Don, you made an observation that I have never been able to let go of. And you described these little guys with the red eyes as as quiet and almost floating and dancing on top of the bushes without making sounds, right?
Right. Yes. Well, and I even said to Steve, I said, how are those little creatures on that bush, because it wasn't a tree with big branches, it was a bush. It's like, how are those little creatures crawling all over that bush and they're not wading down, the limbs? I didn't understand. It was kind of defying, reason of our Earth properties.
They should have crushed the bush and made a bunch of noise, and they did not.
Right, exactly. And so it shouldn't have been able to support them.
And also, the image that I have is almost that they were dancing or happy or frantic, but they were in motion.
Yes, they were in motion. And as it turns out, as the night went on, the more scared or terrified we became, the happier they became. And they would get even more animated and jump on top of the truck and jump all around, just taunting.
That's really creepy. I mean, that's really, really creepy. The more scared that you got, the happier they were and the noisier they got.
Yep.
Wow. Okay. Now, the two sentries, the sentinels, the guards, we're going to be up against a break here in 3 minutes. The sentries, the guards, you've described them as luminescent, shiny. They were a different color than the guys with the red eyes. And I picture them being almost like fire hydrants or tree stumps. You know, they're short, they're wide, and they're there to make sure you guys got the message that they were there to keep you in line. What made you think that that was their job?
Well, I would say one of the times where I thought I was going to try to jump out of the truck to kind of confront them. And as I moved forward, they advanced the same distance right at me. And actually, I almost put my hand out and could feel a very strong, like, you know, almost like you'd say electrical fence or shock that kind of held me back from getting out. And as I backed up and sat back down, it moved right back to the same position it was. And they both stayed there. And it was definitely, you know, one was there watching my every move and movement and I think monitoring my heart rate and everything else about me. And the other was doing the same for Dawn.
Like an E.T. Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
Like an E.T. Mike Tyson that you knew you could not mess around, right?
Right. You can't get in the ring with that.
Yeah, exactly. And you knew that. So did that cause you guys to relax, or was that pretty intimidating that you couldn't step out of line?
Yeah, I don't think there was anything relaxing about that. It just made us feel more entrapped.
Well, I thought that at that point we were definitely going to die. There was no doubt. I mean, my heart was racing, about ready to explode out of my chest at that time when all these things came to that point. So it was no relaxing at all. It was definitely a very traumatic experience at that point.
Yeah, and this is for the audience. I want them to understand kind of, you know, this thing here. So with these two sentries there, did it seem that sentinels, what have you, guards, did it seem that the red-eyed guys were, that there was hierarchy in the army? Did these guys outrank the red-eyed guys? You know what I mean? Is that how it felt when they arrived?
Yeah. I mean, those little monkey guys, they didn't seem to have any kind of order or discipline or anything. I still don't know what their purpose was, but the sentinels, those guys, they were there to do a job.
Interesting. And did they have five fingers, five toes? Did they have a uniform? Did they have eyes, ears? What did they look like?
They definitely had eyes. They had very ugly faces, very ugly, very square, elongated, stumpy heads. And I don't remember their fingers.
No, I think they were more almost kind of, you almost picture them wearing like a cloak kind of like their head or almost like a hooded head like a monk would wear. But they didn't really expose arms or appendages.
Yeah, I don't
they
remember.
They seemed to be very stumpy.
Wow, that is just the creepiest of the creepy. And let's take a quick break. We'll be back tonight. It is the Mojave Incident Live. We have author Ron Felber here keeping me in line. And Steve and Dawn Hess for the first time on Fade to Black telling their story about what happened on that night in 1989. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Fade to Black. I'll be right back.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church.
You're listening to Fade to Black.
Always on the edge of the hottest alternative talk. Jimmy Church with Fade to Black. KGRARadio.com.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón. Y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Hey, I'll make you a deal.
Give me 60 seconds, and I'll give you directions to the Fountain of Youth. Okay, I'm joking. Well, we're kind of joking. No fountains, but youth, I got. Nature's Youth and their premier anti-aging product, Nature's Youth RSF. With your sensible diet and exercise plan, Nature's Youth RSF can help you look and feel better. RSF is an all-natural amino acid supplement that supports your body to naturally increase HGH levels without any synthetic hormones. And elevated HGH levels can contribute to increased energy, improved libido, reduced body fat, and improved exercise capacity. Let's be honest, who doesn't want to look and feel younger? Visit the newly designed website at naturesyouth.com or call 800-333-6923. That's 800-333-6923 and like them on Facebook and you'll be included in contest and exclusive offers. What a deal. Oh, speaking of deals, my time's about up. 800-333-6923 or naturesyouth.com. Who needs a fountain anyway? Call today.
Did you ever turn to your radio for your favorite talk show to find that it's been preempted for this?
In the air to deep right center. Back goes Lewis to the wall. And it's out of here!
Or this?
And I'm ashamed of you, Hillary, for voting for it.
Do you have a favorite talk radio program that's not available in your city? Just go to TalkStreamLive.com for links to the best streaming talk radio shows. At TalkStream Live, you will find live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All your favorites are here. With such a large selection, you will also discover some new favorites. On the go and still want to listen? With the mobile smartphone, simply type TalkStream Live on your internet browser. Now you can take internet radio with you. You will also find hundreds of music, news, and sports streams. Best of all, the TalkStream Live directory is free and there's never a login required. Remember TalkStreamLive.com, the fastest route between you and your favorite talk radio show.
You are listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Back to Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Bespoke radio for the masses on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet. In 1989, Steve and Dawn Hess headed out to the Mojave Desert. They wanted a quiet camping trip alone, away from the kids. But when they were kidnapped by what they believed to be a swarm of alien beings, the shock and pain of the experience changed their lives forever. Tonight, author Ron Felber joins Steve and Dawn Hess right here to tell their story, The Mojave Incident, live on Fade to Black. Now, guys, I'm going to do the short recap. You've been surrounded now at your campsite by a swarm, thousands of little red-eyed creatures that are dancing and freaking out as you guys get upset. They are happy. You've got a couple of guards or sentinels, a couple of E.T. Mike Tysons out in back of the truck, keeping you in order. Steve, you were armed. You put your gun down because they told you to. It wasn't going to do any good. And if you did something stupid with it, bad things were going to happen. And you understood that. And that's where we are now. Before we move on, I've got a whole list of questions that has popped in Twitter. So I just want to, you know, we can answer these very quickly, but it's an audience show, okay? And everybody's participating. Let's see. I'll go to Dale says, good evening, Jimmy. How can you ask them how they walked? Now, and he's talking about the Sentinels. How did they walk? Did you see them walk? What did they do when they approached you?
I didn't think they walked it off. They just kind of floated along back and forth.
Interesting.
So they definitely didn't. And I would say that the smaller creatures definitely seemed to have legs and were running and bounding about, but these two sentinels did not. Just kind of hovered about and moved independently, or just stood in the same place, because if we didn't move, they didn't move, really.
And Brandon wants to know, what color were they? You describe them as shimmering, but what kind of color?
You know what I would use to describe, because it's unlike really anything, an actual color, it's like the color of electricity, that bluish glow from electricity.
Like lightning?
Bluish, grayish.
Like lightning?
Some kind of energy.
Okay. All right. I'll go with that. And let's see. Illustrious, were the sentinels carrying any weapons?
Not that we could see.
Not that we could see, for sure. Nothing.
Okay. And Adam wants to know, did they have a smell? Did you smell anything strange? Not yet. I don't want to jump forward. The sentinels themselves, did they stink? Was there anything going on?
Well, at this point, we really didn't smell a whole lot, but I think there's probably, he kind of hit it on the head that there was more to come.
Right.
That did have other types of sensations, and smell was definitely one that was prominent, but at this point, not now.
And then Dan really asked a good question here, and it's tremendously great. He wants to know if they were moving like schools of fish. Were they swarming together like, schools of fish, or how birds in the sky all move together? Is that how the red-eyed guys were moving?
Yeah, basically it would be like a school of fish, because they were coming at the very same speed. They were following each other. They weren't in regimented lines, but that's a great analogy, because like a school of fish, they were all staying together, all coming and reaching the destination at the same time.
You. The destination was you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We were their destination, I guess.
Did you feel, the predator type of thing? Were you feeling like that? You were food, you were the victim, they were converging on you.
Yeah, victims for sure. Food source, not so much.
Okay. I'm so creeped out right now. I think I need to turn on the lights. Oh, for the audience that doesn't know, on Saturday night at Coast, when I was talking with Ron and Steve and Dawn, I had the lights down at the Coast studio, and you guys are telling me the story, and I'm getting really freaked out, and something happened below my feet. I got to tell the audience I don't want to pull away from what's happening right now, but it freaked me out. And I pulled, you guys don't know this. Oh, I haven't even told you what happened. Okay, so I don't know what part of the story we were in, right? But we're there, and I'm getting freaked out, and the lights are down, and I'm listening, and I'm all into it. And then below my feet, I feel like five very distinct thumps. Boom, 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 boom. Below my feet. And I looked over at my engineer, Nathan, and I rip my headphones off. Now, you guys are still talking. You're doing your thing. I'm freaking out. He sees me freaking out. And I pull my headphones off. And he looks at me, and he gives me the WTF lips, right? And I go, dude. And I hit the mute button. I go, did you feel that? And he goes, no. And so I put the headphones back on. I'm continuing talking to you. And I write down I get an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper, and I write down in big letters, I felt something below my feet. And I hand that to him, and my hands are shaking. I'm tripping out, and I'm listening to you guys, and he's now freaked out. And we went right to commercial break. That's where we got lucky. And he goes, dude, what? I was like, you have no idea, man. I'm so freaked out right now. I'm so freaked out. What was that? And we have things in the studio to look for earthquakes that hang from the ceiling. You know, businesses have those here in Southern California. And we're staring at those. And it was out of control.
Wow.
And then we, yeah, and we come back after the break, and I think I mentioned it live on the air. And
yeah.
I was cool and collected on the air when I was speaking about it. I was out of my mind, and it was perfect timing for whatever. It doesn't matter what part of the story, but it happened. It happened live on the air, and I posted the picture in Twitter. Somebody in Twitter post the note that I posted on Saturday night. I'll retweet it right now. But Twitter, I posted it, and it says right there, I felt something below my feet. And wow, what a moment. It was something that you just can't recreate. But somebody will post it in Twitter, and I'll retweet it for everybody. Okay, so now let's get back to it. This is a critical moment, and
yeah.
it's things are about to get, if they weren't crazy at this point, they get really crazy. I've read the book twice, and I remember the chapter ending, like right here. Ron, you know what I'm talking about. And I was thinking, yeah. Okay, wow, that's pretty interesting, you know, and I had no idea. I remember went, oh, wait a minute, I'm only halfway through the book. What happens next? I mean, how can this story go further? Because it's one of those books where you are pounding the pages. You know, you're just doosh. You can't
stop. And you know, the complexity of the story and the breadth of the story and the depth of the story, I that's immediately what captivated me.
Yeah,
I mean, I don't know that there's another like it.
Yeah, right now, if this was a movie, the movie could end right here. You know what I mean? It's
yeah,
done.
Sure.
You know, it's got everything that you need. Okay, I'm retweeting now, everybody. There you go. You can go and see my my note, and it says felt something under my feet. You guys need to jump into Twitter and check this out. There it is. Okay, everybody, for the world to see. Okay, who wants to go next, Dawn or Steve? What happens at this point?
Steve does.
Well, I would take it from here just to say that at this point, again, I think as I described it, you know, I thought this was it. We were going to die at any moment. But I think part of those Sentinels' job was to keep us alive, to endure more things to come. And at that point, I think, you know, we almost got somewhat of a little calming sensation that restored our breathing, our hyperventilating, and kind of being able to catch our breath, as it were.
Almost like a laboratory clinician keeping something alive so it could keep the experiment going. About right, Steve?
I would say that would be a good description, and certainly not to say that I was any more relaxed. I was a little more relaxed, but still very tense at the time.
But you weren't dead and you didn't have a heart attack.
I wasn't
right?
dead and didn't
no,
have a heart
we
attack.
We were in shock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But at this point in time, this is kind of when other things started happening. I think it was right at this time that we kind of looked up out the back of the truck and saw what I would describe as to be their main ship or the mothership, their vehicle coming into the valley, again approaching from the west, headed east. I could see the front edge of it. You couldn't see the sides because it was so massive and spanned throughout that whole valley. And it floated across and capped the valley and was immediately over the top of us. And as that kind of got stationary there, almost went back to seeing those blinking lights that we had seen earlier. Now to notice that they were smaller craft that were attached underneath that ship that now came down and started to float down and start searching the desert with an instrument I would describe as a bright laser arm attached to a craft that shined a very specific light, very precise and laser-like, in a triangle form that was extremely bright. And they kind of spread out through the valley and started searching the desert floor, almost in a grid-type pattern, very meticulously looking for things. And as they were doing that, Don and I were both, you know, asking each other the whole time, are you seeing this? Exactly what's happening? Are you pinching me now? Am I still awake? Am I dreaming or not? And then we could see things being pulled up and transported out of that light. So it was very methodically as they went through. It wasn't a fast pace. It was a very slow pace, but they were combing the desert out in front of us and seemed to be looking for something very intently.
Steve, was this a massive, like, Steven Spielberg Close Encounters of the Third Kind mothership with lights and massive, just huge, filling up the sky object?
I would say that's a great description of it. But so much on the bottom side didn't seem to be, you know, a whole bunch of lights. There certainly were lights underneath it.
But not so colorful.
Not so colorful, yeah.
Interesting. So more like, and I don't want to use the Hollywood analogy here, but I need a visualization for myself and the audience. Are we talking something more like Independence Day? You know, a darker craft. It still had lights, but wasn't pretty, right?
I would definitely say that's kind of a nearer description, yes.
And how were you guys feeling at this point when something like that comes overhead and it's dangling seven or eight other craft off of cables and it's descending these smaller craft to the... Is it adrenaline taking over? Are you having heart attacks? Is this end of the world? Or were you guys able to maintain?
I'll let Don say.
I think it bought us a little bit of time on our panic attack because now we're looking at their, you know, seemingly scientific search out there, and I think it almost made us wonder, oh, you know, maybe they need something from the desert. We happen to be here. Maybe, you know, maybe they don't want us.
That's an interesting observation. You guys may have just been in the way.
Right. That's what we were holding on to. I think it gave us a little bit of solace. Not that we weren't still having panic attacks, but at least it felt like it took just a tiny bit of pressure off of us, thinking, oh, maybe they'll find what they're searching for out there and then just leave.
That's, and if only you could know what was about to happen next. That comforting thought is fleeting. You know, it's just for a moment. But I can understand that because you're trying to maintain. You know, you don't want to think that you're crazy. You don't want to think that you're like, you know, you're trying to find answers in the moment. And that's what you guys were searching for. Very interesting. But that's not what happens. So these craft are now doing their work out in the desert. Possibly you think that they may even be extracting minerals and stuff out of the ground because you see that. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but we're going to move on from this in just a second. So they're out there working in the desert. You see that. You've got the craft overhead. What happens to the blinking eye swarm?
Well, they're still there continuously and kind of just hanging out, not really trying to jump in the truck, to staying on the perimeter. But the whole time, they're still kind of running around being mischievous. But it was about this time, as we saw them searching throughout the desert, and seemingly they started from a far area, and the craft were getting closer and closer, and obviously that raised our anxiety level. And it was probably at that time where it almost seemed like they were coming. It just took them a matter of time to work their way across the valley to get us. And it was about that time where, again, heart attack, panic level was there. And then something happened, almost like a kind of a calming mist or a fog kind of rolled in and, again, kind of restored us. And it was right about that time that a third set of beings appeared. And these would be what we determined to be more your typical aliens or grays described with the big eyes, the childish body, but, 4 to 5 feet tall, long arms and appendages. And at that time, that's when we took on a very distinct odor, a very strong, sulfury smell coincided with the arrival of these beings.
And I'm thinking chemical, chemtrail. I'm thinking, some kind of gas, something like that that was used to medicate you or pacify you or calm you down or have an effect on you, that it wasn't for some grand entrance at, WWE. That's not what the mist was for. The mist was there to medicate you.
Medicate us, yeah.
Is that what you thought, Steve? Because was it immediate? I mean, was it like...
It was immediate effect, and it was certainly very calming. And the fact that I could breathe normal, and like I said, Don and I were communicating each other, both verbally and almost, being married, knowing each other, it almost, came and kind of coincided with the fact that we could almost hear each other's thoughts, but we were definitely verbalizing everything we were hearing, seeing, smelling, cross-checking this thing, because obviously this is not real. It could not be real.
Right.
But it was very real. There was no denying it, and I think that's the toughest part about it. It's just...
How did the grays approach you? Did they walk? You said there was three, right?
Actually, there's more than that. There's probably, I would say, a dozen, maybe 15.
No,
nine to a dozen.
Nine to a dozen. And were they walking?
They seemed to be more...
They were standing.
Standing, and they were peering into the back of the truck, both through the side windows and the back. They almost seemed to be coming out of curiosity and almost gave me the feeling that we were, trapped in our cage in the back of the camper, and they were coming just to look and check us out and kind of walk back and forth and peered in.
That's interesting. So it's almost like the swarm, right, the red-eyed guys and the sentries found you, called back to base, right? Hey, check this out. We have some, we found a couple of creatures, right?
Right.
And then the, the higher ups, the grays, show up to see what they were told that these other guys have found. And the two sentinels were there to make sure that possibly that you didn't leave. And they were holding you there in the back of the truck so you couldn't get out until their bosses showed up. Is that a scenario that was kind of playing out here?
I think that's a great description, because when you talked about a hierarchy, there definitely was.
Right.
And they were on the top of that order between those three things that we had saw at this point in time. And, again, they seemed to be almost more scientific in nature in how they were observing us.
Inquisitive.
And then, again... Partly what happened at this point in time is when kind of the more mind games and mind terror started with their arrival.
And before we get to that, just a quick answer. Was there a leader out of these nine, and one that stood out, maybe a different uniform, different hair, if they had any? I don't know.
But they didn't have any hair. I think they all looked practically identical, and I don't think that there was any kind of leadership that we were aware of.
Steve, did you see anybody that would stand out?
No. It seemed like they were kind of all working together, as it were.
Okay.
But definitely had a very distinct purpose on what they wanted to do or accomplish. And, it started with observingness and moving on one phase to the next.
Now, this is one of the strangest parts of, if you can actually say that, about... your experience. This is one of the strangest parts, And it affected me greatly when I read this in the book. I want to tell you guys right now, emotionally, it ripped me apart. And it was a very, very heavy thing. And the way that Ron writes about it in the book, I'm hoping that he was accurate. I hope it wasn't worse, is what I'm trying to say. But it was a very emotional thing. And out of all of the experiencers that I have interviewed, nobody has ever described something like this. Now, as if that isn't dramatic enough to, you know, to set this up, but it is true. Now, before we get to this, I want to thank both of you for talking about this, because tonight we're going to talk about it. We didn't do it on Coast for obvious reasons, but tonight we're going to talk about this, and it is very personal. It's very emotional. It's very deep. It's very traumatic, but we need to cover this. Both of you were forced to remember and relive very traumatic experiences from your childhood. So before we head to the break, I want each of you to describe briefly, we'll do it in detail after the break, what it was that they apparently chose, that's the correct word, these events in your life for you to remember. And you could not, or recall, and relive, and you couldn't do anything about it. And that is what is so heavy here. So, Steve, take 1 minute and tell us about the event that they were forcing you to relive.
Well, for me, it was a kind of a fear attack, some of your greatest fears, and really put into your mind that myself being a hunter all my life and actually being on this trip as part of a hunter, they put me in a position to believe I was the animal being hunted and shot and skinned and killed, and really ran me through a vast array of emotions with that and other things in my life that really, I don't know, for all purposes was to get my reaction or test my emotions, but there was definitely a very realistic emotions that I experienced by going through this. And it was terrifying, to say the least.
And for you, Dawn, what was the life event that they forced you to relive?
Well, I was attacked as an 8-year-old child by a stranger, and I was forced to relive the whole experience. And it went from that, which was horrific, to the birth of our first child. The scenario was that he was born with a hole in his heart, and just finding out the news, you know, that he's turning blue, he needs oxygen, and I'll leave it at that.
It is, you know, for both of you, these experiences, you know, for you, Steve, and, you know, to hunt an animal and to put you in the mindset of the animal that's being hunted, what it feels like to get shot, then skinned, is about as traumatic as it could get. I don't know how to do that. And for you, Dawn, as a mother, and as a young girl, to have both of those experiences in your life, one, to be attacked when you were 8 years old, very, very traumatic. Nobody should ever, ever go through that. I'm a parent, and to think about my children going through something like that, that's enough. And then the birth of your child who is struggling to live, and they are making you relive that. That experience, and it's heavy, and we're going to talk about this and what it really meant right after this break. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, Steve and Dawn Hess are here. We are reliving the Mojave Desert incident live with author Ron Felber. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
The Metal God on JimmyChurchRadio.com. KGRA Radio. Intelligent talk.
Why do people order Life Change Tea? Because Life Change Tea helps the digestive system. Life Change Tea helps the colon unclog. The tea also helps with high blood pressure, high cholesterol, and many, many other health issues. Life Change Tea also tastes great. And Life Change Tea is not just green tea. Life Change Tea is a unique blend of 8 different herbs that go to town, cleaning your body of harmful toxins, bacteria, and parasites. Our tea is number one. Are you ready for your life change? Let the tea help you. Log on to our online store of helpful products to get your body on track. Log on to getthetea.com. That's getthetea.com. Or you can call us at 928-308-0408. That's 928-308-0408. Not all tea is equal. Read our website of all the factual testimonies that prove that Life Change Tea is working. Health is important, and our quality of life is very important. Don't wait to order. Expect a life change with Life Change Tea at getthetea.com.
Hi, I'm Richard Dolan. When I'm not hosting my radio program, The Richard Dolan Show on KGRA, or writing new books on UFOs, I run a publishing company. I'm proud to say that Richard Dolan Press has published some of the most fascinating books available on UFOs and related subjects. They include Dr. Bruce McAbee's classic analysis of the UFO cover-up, David Marler's breakthrough book on triangular UFOs, Dr. Richard Sauter's unique work on underground bases, and other classics by Grant Cameron, Chase Kletsky, and Dr. Bob Wood. Not to mention intriguing works by Eve Lorgan and Laurie McDonald that deal with truly bizarre phenomena. I'm proud to publish such high-quality and original works, and there are several amazing books about to be released over the next few months. Go to richarddolanpress.com to learn more.
Did you know that when you're on the road with limited data or Wi-Fi available, you can still listen to every minute of Fade to Black by just calling 605-562-4482. No smartphone, app, or internet needed. It saves your data plan and no extra cost if you have unlimited minutes. Just call 605-562-4482. You can listen to me, Jimmy Church, on any phone, anytime, anywhere. Go Beckley Tappy.
You want to know a secret? I love ponies. I really love ponies. I'm serious. I couldn't stay sane without ponies to brush.
Why fade to black? Because you never got that pony, damn it.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Bespoke Radio for the masses. On the Game Changer Network and KGRA, the planet. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, author Ron Felber, Steve and Dawn Hess. We are doing the Mojave incident live. And everybody, I just want to do, again, just a quick recap for everybody that is just joining the show, which is at your campsite, you were surrounded by these thousands of red-eyed creatures. A couple of sentinels came out, made sure that you didn't leave the back of your pickup truck. Steve is armed. He's put his guns down. And then, amongst other things, but 9, 8, 7, 8, 9, 10 gray alien beings step up to the truck. And then they start a little bit of mind experiments with you and force both of you to relive some traumatic experiences. And that's where things are now. And I have to ask out of the gate, and I'll ask Steve first, but Dawn, I'd like for you to answer to very directly. Why do you think they forced you to relive your experience? Steve, why do you think that was done?
Well, I certainly don't understand why, but it seemed like they were.
Oh, did I lose you, Steve? Okay. Wow. Very strange. Are you guys still there?
I'm still on, Jimmy.
Okay.
This is Ron.
Okay. I've lost them. Hang on for a second, Ron. Okay. I'm gonna mute and bring them right back. Just stay with me.
Sure, of course.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We lost them, but we're bringing them back. And I have to do that in silence, but they'll be back with us. But that was bizarre.
Please try again later.
Oh, we lost them completely. Interesting. Right in the middle of a sentence, too. Okay, let's... I still don't have them. Very strange. Ron... Okay, let me do this. Ron, you just stay right there. Let me, I'm going to break to another commercial. I'm just going to do this
fine.
Because
mm-hmm.
I have to do this in real time. And this is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. I'll get Steve and Dawn Hess right back right after this short break. You stay with us.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church.
You're listening to Fade to Black.
Always on the edge of the hottest alternative talk. Jimmy Church with Fade to Black. KGRARadio.com.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón. Y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Hey, I'll make you a deal. Give me 60 seconds, and I'll give you directions to the Fountain of Youth. Okay, I'm joking. Well, kind of joking. No fountains, but youth, I got. Nature's Youth and their premier anti-aging product, Nature's Youth RSF. With your sensible diet and exercise plan, Nature's Youth RSF can help you look and feel better. RSF is an all-natural amino acid supplement that supports your body to naturally increase HGH levels without any synthetic hormones. And elevated HGH levels can contribute to increased energy, improved libido, reduced body fat, and improved exercise capacity. Let's be honest, who doesn't want to look and feel younger? Visit the newly designed website at naturesyouth.com or call 800-333-6923. That's 800-333-6923 and like them on Facebook and you'll be included in contest and exclusive offers. What a deal. Oh, speaking of deals, my time's about up. 800-333-6923 or naturesyouth.com. Who needs a fountain anyway? Call today.
Did you ever turn to your radio for your favorite talk show to find that it's been preempted for this?
In the air to deep right center.
I'm sorry. This mailbox has not yet been set up by the subscriber.
Or this?
And I'm ashamed of you and Hillary for voting for it.
Do you have a favorite talk radio program that's not available in your city? Just go to TalkStreamLive.com for links to the best streaming talk radio shows. At TalkStream Live, you will find live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All your favorites are here. With such a large selection, you will also discover some new favorites. On the go and still want to listen? With a mobile smartphone, simply type TalkStream Live on your internet browser. Now you can take internet radio with you. You will also find hundreds of music, news, and sports streams. Best of all, the TalkStream Live directory is free and there's never a login required. Remember TalkStreamLive.com, the fastest route between you and your favorite talk radio show.
You are listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Oi, oi, I'm Rhys Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
All right, welcome back. Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. Yeah. Okay. That was interesting, but I think...
palpitations.
Yeah, I think we're all good now. That was weird. You said you just heard dial tone, right?
Right.
Wow. And you know what we heard on this end?
What?
That's what we heard. And it was just gone. Okay, let's try to make up for the lost 6 minutes there. Steve, the question was, why do you think they were forcing you to relive this? Do you have any reason why?
I don't, but I certainly thought that they were very unemotional and very scientific in their approach, almost like they didn't have emotions. We're trying to experiment with my human emotions, and to watch the full reaction as they took me through this full gamut of highs and lows in my life and put me in situations to see how I would react. And that's the only thing I could think of, because certainly I don't think there's any other reason for it that I can imagine.
And Dawn, for you, what, you know, why would they force you to do that?
I mean, at the time, I could not even imagine why. I couldn't imagine anything more cruel. It was almost felt like punishment at that time. You know, 25 years later, in retrospect, it's, you know, I have to think of it as a scientific study, you know, of our reactions to trauma.
The coincidence side of this that we were referring to earlier, that they were there to maybe do some mining and they just stumbled upon you guys, and then you introduce this element of the experience. Now mm-hmm. The coincidence side is kind of blown out of the water, isn't it? Because now it appears that they knew exactly who the two of you were.
Yeah, that was really an unfortunate realization that they were after more than just minerals in the desert. Now it's personal.
Yeah, I think that's the more scary part, in the fact that they could access and download our memories or our mind.
Right.
And see those emotions. It was.
And be able to go to the most traumatic experiences in our lives.
And at this point, how long after you had done, obviously you have to recover mentally and you two are there for each other at this moment, and you're both going through heart rate and different things, but how much time elapsed before the next ET or being showed up? How much time elapsed? Can you recall that?
I would say, in trying to guesstimate time, I know this ordeal happened over about, I would have to say, between 6 and 8 hours of the night.
Right.
So this was not a short happening. These were long, drawn out, very distinct phases of their investigation, I guess you'd say.
Right.
But our experience was not one where, you know, everything happens in 4 or 5 minutes and we're over. It was ongoing and ever increasing in intensity, going from high to low and then kind of back again. And it was kind of a continuous cycle, as it were.
And tell me about the angelic being. Who saw her first?
I think I saw her first. We were at a point, we had just gone through these mind terrors. I think we were both, I know I was at a point where I just didn't think I could take any more of anything. It was just too much, and I was starting to shut down. And, you know, I almost welcomed death over going through any more of that torture. And just as I was saying to Steve, you know, I can't take any more. Out the back, out the side window, I think the light first caught my eye, but there was, you know, all I can describe her as is, you know, an angel. You know, not with wings and all that typical, you know, Hollywood kind of angel. I mean, this was a a woman in a white flowing gown who was levitating probably, I don't know, 8 or 10 feet off the ground, you know, just above our eye levels and close enough that, you know, we could feel and see her serenity. And we both heard in our minds, it's almost over. You're not going to be harmed. Everything's going to be okay. And those were the exact words we heard in our minds.
Did you feel...
I have a quick question. Dawn, you maybe read about Marian visitations, like at Fatima or at Lourdes, things of that nature. Mm-hmm. Would it be something like that or not like that?
Well, I think it probably would be like that because here is a human spirit, I'd like to think, or at least a heavenly spirit in a that looks human, someone we can relate to, and obviously in an angelic form, you know, peaceful and bright and white and.
I was thinking more like the Good Witch in Wizard of Oz.
Oh yes.
I'm not
more angelic than her. There was no sparkles. There was no crown or wand. It was just her in a, you know, her just a simple white gown that it had a little bit of movement because she was levitating. She wasn't standing on the ground, but.
But were you thinking, okay, holy crap, finally we're saved.
Yeah, we thought God has heard our prayers.
Right.
And I'm going to take her word for it. You know, okay, it's going to be okay.
Right.
And
right.
It was really just a short time after that that, you know, we were released. And
well, let's not go there yet. I got to throw the same thing at Steve because Dawn saw this out the window first and she sees this coming down. Steve, at what point did you feel, you know, the tension kind of release and things kind of change?
Well, when she saw it, I would say that we very much saw it and felt it probably even more simultaneously. And she did kind of float more on the western side, on the side of the truck that we've seen. But she was behind the window maybe slightly, but moved out in very plain view where there was no strain to look out of the back of the truck to see this happening. But I guess going back to our earlier conversation about a hierarchy, this was one of the things that I immediately noticed is all the prior beings ceased and stopped all their activity when she arrived. And it was almost like, okay, this is enough. We're stopping here.
Did she look human?
Yes. But definitely looked female. Looked like, again, more flowing, longish, blondish hair. I would say describe a very bright, white, light gown that was shimmering and very...
Was she attractive?
I would say yes, but you know, you can kind of see detailed, super detailed features on her face. I would say maybe not, but certainly could recognize it as a human form that made me feel at ease and was very comfortable with.
Like natural beauty.
Natural beauty. Interesting description. And was she, now you described her as being really tall. Could she walk down the street and not... Yeah, could she blend into a crowd?
No.
I don't think so, because she definitely was not of our size, not someone 6 foot, I would say. You know, seemed like more.
She was taller. Okay.
8 to 9 feet, kind of.
Yeah, she was magnified.
Interesting, interesting. Okay, guys, what happens next?
Well, I guess it's we start feeling hydraulics under the truck.
Mechanical?
No, I would say at this point definitely felt like almost the truck got scooped up. I mean, we can feel vibration. The truck vibrated violently, almost like it was sliding on the ground without moving on the earth at all. But almost like there was a big scoop of total plot of land that we were sitting on.
Earthquake?
No. Not so much an earthquake, but definitely very distinct shaking of the truck, dragging across the desert, almost a pulling sensation like you're being pulled on a sled across the dirt, but you're not moving, but the whole earth is moving with you. And the next thing we kind of experienced is that we were kind of levitating. It felt almost like air around us, that we were floating sensation.
Did you look out the windows to see if you were indeed floating?
We did look out the windows and look out the back of the truck, and really we seen the plot of dirt that we were on still all intact. But the sensation was certainly different. And it was about that time on, you know, you would think, you know, all right, we're all excited that something's going to happen, this and that. It was kind of the opposite. We almost got to the point where we were totally exhausted, and we felt like, okay, it's time to go to bed. And how can you think you can just fall asleep? And I think that's what happened. We just all fully clothed, laid on the bed, and that was probably our last memory of the conscious side.
But first, before we laid down, we saw the moon. And that was the first time we'd seen the moon since it all started. And I said, they gave us our moon back. And as we stared at the moon, which was a crescent shape then, that's when we became just absolutely fatigued, like can't keep your eyes open, fatigued.
And that was it. Now, this is what I was referring to earlier. In the book, this is the end of that chapter, right? And I just remember going, this is heavy stuff. And then I turn the page and there's another chapter. And I think Ron starts the chapter off, and I encourage everybody to get the book, go and do it and go and read it. Because Ron, correct me if I'm wrong, this is my memory, but I think you started off with, if you think it was crazy, just wait till what happens next. Right?
Something pretty much like that.
Yeah. And I thought, no way, really. And I, you know, like I said, you know, I'm halfway through the book, and boom, I take off on this next part of the journey. And let's set all of this up. Now, we're going to, this is what we have here. We have a little bit of leeway. We've got about a half an hour. Okay. So we can get it all in. We don't have to. Everybody can go and get the book. But we're going to set this up now. You guys go home. But there's a critical thing to me, and Ron, I think you'll agree with me. There's a critical thing that happens here. And I just referred to Wizard of Oz earlier. You know, Dorothy gets back to Kansas, right? And then she looks around and she realizes that everybody in her experience is part of it. And then she realizes, well, you know what? Maybe that wasn't a dream, right? You guys have that same bleeping experience. You wake up in the morning, you drive around, you quiz who you can quiz, right? Did you guys see anything last night? No. Did you guys see? No, nothing. No. And you jump in the car, you're driving, and you must be thinking to yourself, it was all just a dream. It was crazy. I know. You're driving up the road, and then Dawn, you look out the window, and what do you see?
I caught a reflection of something bright and shiny out my window, and I turned my head around to look because it's a little bit in back of us, and there's one of these orbs. It's not like a spaceship. It's just like a bright orb is following us.
Man.
On the freeway.
Yeah. And did you point it out to Steve?
Well, yeah. It's like, oh, you know, I'm freaking out. It's like, there's somebody following us. And it's just like, what? You know, and
Steve,
and
what,
he looks, and it's just like, don't stop. Just keep going.
You damn Skippy. Steve, what
right?
did you, yeah. Steve, what did you see?
Well, definitely, I was driving, trying to keep my eyes on the road, but I definitely saw it and felt it, presence kind of being there, but I almost want to say, you know, taking us back to what happened that morning that we woke up, because it was probably the stranger of feelings that we had, is we woke up not knowing what day it was, what year it was, how much time had passed, were we still in the desert? All those things hit us so badly. And I got out of the truck in the morning, and it was kind of a weird type of morning that day, is because when we woke up, when we finally woke up, the sun was already up high in the sky. It wasn't like, we're waking up as the sun is rising, which you think you probably would have, but it was very bright outside. And of course, searching for answers and truth, I got out and scoured everything that happened, tried to rethink and retrace everything that happened, and Donna and I doing the same. And as you mentioned, we made our way back to civilization, or towards that way, and stopping along the way to try to talk to someone who must have saw something, because of all that happened, I sure didn't think it could have gone unnoticed. But it was a very strange feeling. And again, once we left and we saw that thing following us, I just thought maybe this isn't quite ended yet.
So let's, we've got 3 minutes, and let's kind of compress this a little bit. You guys go home. Obviously life is different now for you both. There's no question about that. Steve, how was your personal life with work and how you were dealing with things? What did you go through?
Well, definitely, I think it was a tough time in our lives. That was, this was continuously in the forefront of my mind, something that I couldn't forget, and certainly burned right into my memory banks so vividly, and certainly wanted to find answers or search for it. And I think it made me, lose focus on other things. Certainly motivation to work, knowing that, we could be gone in any day. That kind of thought in the back of your mind, and just really trying to search for answers. Why it happened to us? Were we in the wrong place at the wrong time? Was this something that had been planned, and we followed all these steps of our lives to lead us in this place? I don't know. It's just something that really tears at you from the inside. And of course, fear, ridicule of sharing this type of information and an event about yourself and leaving yourself open to ridicule, I guess it is. And thinking about the climate at that time about people, I've seen people that reported on UFOs back then, and it was either two things. They were crazy as crazy or on drugs. And I know neither was the case in my case. And so it was a tough thing to stay focused on your regular life. But I think that's really how we dealt with it, as we buckled down and,
Well, Dawn,
live our normal life.
Well, Dawn, how did it affect your marriage?
Well, you know what? Just the way stress affects a marriage, snappiness and fatigue and all those things. But we went through it together, so at least we had that to share and shoulder that burden together, and gratefully so. If I went through this alone, I don't know how I would have gone on.
Right.
But we did have each other.
30 seconds, and then we've got to hit a break. 30 seconds. So you jumped into UFO research, and rightly so. I would have done the same thing. Was this a 24-hour-a-day attention for you?
No. I had little kids and babies at home. This was, I wonder if there's anything at the library that shows pictures of these things and things we can research. So it was really just a few trips to the library and poring over some books. And we saw pictures of, like the typical grays and things like that to draw that correlation. But there was nothing else like this. So, we can say I researched, but all I did was read, and there was nothing else there.
This is Fade to Black. This is Fade to Black. Tonight, Steve and Dawn Hess, author Ron Felber, The Mojave Incident Live. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Bespoke radio for the masses. I'll be back more with Ron Felber, Steve and Dawn Hess right after this short break. Stay with us.
Vivica Fox here, and you are listening to my boy, Jimmy Church, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
But listening to Jimmy Church will.
Another winter, another cold and flu season. This year, try Sweet Annie's Herbs FACS formula. FACS means flu, allergy, cold, and sinus relief. Vitamin C, echinacea, golden seal, and propolis. Nature's antibiotic and antiviral remedy. Karen from Springfield says, amazing product, a miracle worker for me. Go to SweetAnnie.com and order FACS today. Use promo code TALK for free shipping. This statement has not been evaluated by the Food and Drug Administration. This product is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you, and your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. TalkStream Live, now available in the iTunes App Store.
Hello, Fadernauts. Are you looking for the ultimate Bluetooth speaker system? Well, check this out. The Studio Dome Surround Sound System, featuring the Studio Dome 1 SD1 and the Studio Boombox SBB wireless Bluetooth speakers, is the perfect way to get surround sound without all of the cable headaches. With its own hard shell custom carrying case for taking your surround sound experience on the go. Each hard shell case comes packed with an SBB, two SD1s, cables, and power. It's just $99, and you use the promo code Jimmy, and you get yourself some free shipping. Once again, Studio Dome brings you the best deal on the net. Anywhere. Just go to the Studio Dome banner, JimmyChurchRadio.com, promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
It's not a lifestyle we chose. We were born this way. KGRARadio.com.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. This is one of my favorite shows ever. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, Steve and Dawn Hess are with us with author Ron Felber. We are doing the Mojave incident live. And this is what I want to do, guys. We've got about 20, 25 minutes here. And plenty of time to try to achieve some closure. And if we don't get to it, that's fine. Everybody can go buy the book. We're not here to tell, an epic novel that is umpteen pages and compress it into 3 hours. You just can't pull that off. But I want to jump ahead. You meet Ron. This is kind of a couple of critical things. A lot of things went down with your parents and discussions with them about, I can't imagine how you dealt with that, by the way. My parents think I'm strange enough just to do this show, right? And
yeah.
But so you discuss it with your family, you discuss it with who you can, and a friend or two heard the story too as well, and that enables you to pull Ron into the picture. Ron comes in, hears the story. I'm doing this for the audience. And then says, hey, let's go to Washington, D.C., because I know somebody there, and I think you guys need to talk to him. And you agreed to do that. So you guys go to Washington, D.C., and what was the doctor's name? And, Ron, if you need to jump in, that's fine. We still love you, Ron. You can.
Sure. It was Dr. Bernard Ratone from Georgetown University. A national director of the National Center of Psychiatry in Washington, D.C.
And so you guys arrive at the doctor's office and you sit down. Now, had the doctor up to this point Ron, I don't know if you know this, but had the doctor ever had any experience with a situation like this?
No, I can tell you. These doctors, both of them, I mean, one was, had dealt with the typical things that psychiatrists and medical doctors would, because he was not just a medical doctor, but a renowned psychiatrist. The same with William Annixter, who was the retrogressive hypnotist that Stephen Dawn saw later. But these were really, top flight guys. But neither of them had ever seen anything like this. The retrogressive hypnotist, Annixter, had worked with, victims of crimes. He'd worked with the FBI to help people recall the faces, maybe, of a terrorist that they may have encountered, that kind of thing, or trauma, so traumatized they couldn't remember things, and so hypnosis would draw it out. But neither of them had any experience with anything like this.
And so were you, Stephen Dawn, let me ask Dawn this directly. Were you comfortable with the doctor, and did he look at you like seriously?
He was very compassionate, very thorough, very scientific. We were examined separately, so we weren't together. He treated us with kindness and respect, but he also had a very, serious job to do, and he took it seriously for us.
Steve, were you comfortable?
Well, at this point in time, I thought it was good to be able to talk to someone like this, and some certainly a qualified professional, and, more for your own peace of mind as well. Just dealing with it, hearing with it, basically saying, what could be possibilities? Am I crazy or am I not? Did this happen? Which I know it did. And, again, I think it was a little uncomfortable to expose yourself and talk about it. I know I've had difficult talking about it my whole entire life and this experience, and, the explanation why it's taken 25 years to kind of maybe talk about it a little bit more. It's very traumatic, and it's, something that you don't rush out to tell anybody, and certainly that was my situation. I kept it very close to the vest for many, many years, and just shared it with friends and loved ones, and those that I trusted a little bit more, that knew me as a person.
So he
talked about it first.
So he then recommends that you guys go to South Carolina. And I can imagine, does he write out like a prescription? You know what? I mean, how does he do that? Did he say, go see this guy? Ron, did you know who he was?
Well, I knew Dr. Vitone. I'd gone to Georgetown and was roommates with a fellow that went to medical school with him. But Dr. Annixter, I did not know.
Right.
But they're colleagues. They work together.
Right.
And so, they met at conferences. And so this was not a prescription kind of thing. This was where he got on the phone and said, look, I've got a very unusual case here that requires your specific talents, and I'm hoping you'll help me out.
And that's what you guys do. You head to South Carolina. And let's just go straight to the regressions. Who was regressed first?
I believe it was me that was first.
And Ron, were you present at the regression?
Yeah, absolutely.
Were there other witnesses besides yourself?
My wife.
Your wife. And of course, the doctor.
It was videotaped also.
That was my next question, Ron.
Mm-hmm.
Let me ask the question, okay?
Okay.
Was it videotaped?
Yes. Funny you ask.
Yeah, it's funny. Okay, so it's videotaped. We have a couple of witnesses, which you need to have. That's why I'm asking. So you have got a couple of witnesses. And Ron, really quick, because you were there.
Yeah. Yes.
You didn't know, and neither did Steve, what Steve was about to recall. Am I correct?
No idea.
Okay. All right. Who wants to? Steve is being regressed. Ron, you're the witness. Who would like to tell me what regression memories Steve had?
What? I think it's got to be me because I don't think, Steve, you had any memories of it, really, right? Or...
Right. No, well, you go.
It's definitely very difficult to recall, but I know some of the things they talk about that actually were recorded and Ron reported. So, like I said, being a witness to it, he'd probably be a good testament as to what happened.
Okay, so, Ron, you're in the hot seat then. Let me ask you a couple of questions. And I want to split this up. We're going to do about 5 minutes with Steve's regression, and then we'll do 5 minutes of Dawn, and then we'll close. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Sure.
So, what was Steve's demeanor as he's being regressed? Was he comfortable as he started to remember this stuff, or was he agitated?
He was very agitated. As a matter of fact, the things that he talked about were being in the craft, being separated from Dawn, wondering where she was, and I think being worried about her. He remembered struggling, and even when he was in the chair, the sort of sofa chair, you know, a comfortable cushioned chair, he was squirming at first, but then actually like flailing as if he were fighting things. And he talked about struggling to get away, but not being able to do that.
Let's go to the beginning of this. Did the truck remember? The last memory was the truck vibrating and possibly the earth underneath. Did the whole truck get taken up into the craft?
That was definitely our impression, that we felt that we rose right up into it.
But we have no evidence that supports that.
Right.
Because the next day, the truck's in exactly the same spot that it was.
Right.
And in the retrogression, there was no mention of that. Really, what the first retrogressive thought they had and experience they expressed was being on the spacecraft and going through a like a tunnel and a bright white and sort of a translucent floor, and being on sort of, you know, in the airports, they have the people walkers, the
moving
the people
sidewalks,
movers,
yeah,
that sort of thing.
Right. Now, did Steve know how they were separated? Did he see that, how Dawn was separated from him?
No, he was very concerned. That was really almost the first. You know, a mention of anything was that he was reliving this. I mean, that's what happens when you retrogress somebody. They're actually reliving it. And he was very concerned and very agitated about where Dawn was. He was struggling to get away, and he was really moving around like that. So very agitated, very filled with dread. And, you know, it was really obvious that this was a traumatic experience.
And did experiments, blood, semen, skin, hair, was anything removed from Steve?
Well, this is not the most comfortable thing to talk about, and so I'll not go into great detail, but he remembered being on a table, he remembered fighting, he remembered being probed, he remembered being experimented on, and he was anguished during that, physically, emotionally anguished. And then I just recall very vividly, he said, talked about pain. And then he says the pain stopped. And the doctor said, well, did it stop for good? And he just said, I want to go home. I want to see my kids.
Was he restrained through all of this? Not during the regression, when he was on the craft.
Yeah, I mean, it seemed to... Go ahead, Steve, maybe you want to take that.
Well, I was just going to say, it seemed that we were more in a drug state because it was almost like you were paralyzed, fighting and trying to move, but could not.
Was it the grays that were doing the medical stuff?
Yes, typically that's my memory was of that type of creature.
Did you see
the experiments?
Did you see the angel... being at any point, or was it just the grays that were doing this?
Just the grays at that point in time. That's all I could recall.
Let's move over to Dawn. What happened with Dawn when she was regressed?
Well, you know, Dawn, between the two, and this is, I think, typical of men and women, she's really the recorder of finer detail. So a lot of the things she talked about were very specific. And really, she talked about a similar experience to Steve's in terms of an examination, very agitated about that. She talked about when asked, why are they here? She talked about five galaxies. She talked about that there was the one supreme that wanted to harmonize the five galaxies. She talked about, she says, is there anything else you know? I said, I know where the universe ends. And Dr. Annixter said, is that something you can put in words? And I think the quote was, our universe ends when its matter stops mattering to us and starts mattering to them. And really at that time, it was almost like, maybe Dawn has a memory, I think she saw the videotape, but it was almost like the words she used were not words she would use. They were very like staccato, very, you know, military almost. And the whole demeanor, her whole demeanor changed when she was being talking. When will this happen? The exposure between the aliens and humankind. And she said, I don't know. And then he said, well, in my lifetime. And she said, in your children's.
Did, Dawn, maybe you can answer this directly. Did you see any writing? Did you see any symbols inside the craft? Were you able to, you know, try to look at anything to see anything identifying or anything that you could remember?
I don't recall seeing any.
And
maybe I did, but I don't recall it.
Were there any windows that you could look out of?
No, I don't recall any windows. The only symbol we ever saw was not on the spacecraft. It was actually on the left side of, I'll say, their chest. The Grays were wearing some type of almost a second skin, I'll say uniform, for
right.
lack of a better word. And
right.
there was an upside down, you know, the top of the arrow. I don't know the words for it. Like if you have the top of an arrowhead. Like a delta on their chest.
Interesting. But no deltas or anything like that inside of the craft?
No.
Did you see any, you guys were probably in some type of interior room. Did you ever see like the deck or any type of controls or anything to flight control systems or anything like that?
Well, we may have, but the only thing I recall is the corridor. And the room I was in that was very, it was softly lit, but there was one pendant light coming down with a sterile table and one instrument table next to it. And that's all I recall ever seeing.
And what did it, were you able to, you both can answer this, were you able to breathe freely?
Yeah, I don't remember not being able to breathe, even though, you know, our bodies were like restrained through some kind of paralysis. There were no straps going across us, but I don't remember any labored breathing. In fact, that we must have had some kind of that mist again, because I should have been hyperventilating at that point. And even though I was upset, I was still functioning.
Was there any, two quick questions. Was there any smells that you recall first? And second, how were you guys doing any communicating? I know that we had that message, but, you know, going through all of this.
I don't recall any smells.
Okay.
On the ship. I don't recall any smells. But I felt like I could feel Steve worrying about me. I could feel his panic.
Could you guys hear each other yelling and screaming?
No.
Okay. And what about communication? Oh, Steve, did you smell anything strange?
I did not. And during that period of the experience, certainly prior, I'd say that more conscious state that we were before entering the craft, most definitely.
And what about humid or dry? You know, did it feel dank or did it just feel normal?
It felt normal.
Interesting.
I have to say normal as well.
Yeah, interesting. And any communication, when you guys were going into these medical rooms, for lack of a better description, any communication, or were you guys being, you know, dragged or guided or hand-holding?
Well, going down the corridor before getting to the room, I was upright, you know, and it wasn't like a moving sidewalk. It was like the floor was like glass tiles, but I was going along like I was walking, but I wasn't walking. I must have been somehow levitated down that corridor, because I definitely was not going on my own volition.
which was my next question. You were not wanting to be there, right? But you didn't have a choice. You were going to go into that room.
Right.
Interesting and frightening at the same time. And so you knew that everything was inevitable. You know, things were happening because they were happening. They were not in your control at all.
Right. Believe me, I would not be going down that corridor had I a choice.
Now, this is a question for me. Did these grays with their eyes, did they blink? Do you guys remember that?
Yeah. No, I don't recall them ever blinking.
Steve?
Yeah. I don't believe they did either. They just seemed to be very constant, dark, and big.
Were there any other, we're winding down here, so I've got to get these in. Were there any other beings? Were there anything, you know, insect-like, reptilian-like, or was it just the grays?
Just the grays that I recall.
And no more of the little red-eyed little guys?
No, those guys, we never saw them again.
What about the sentinel dudes?
Nope.
Never saw them. So the rest of the interaction were these gray beings.
Yeah.
And wow. I just can't imagine. Okay. Do you remember how you left the ship?
No.
So they just fell asleep.
Yeah, and I don't remember going back out that corridor. The last thing I think both of us remember is being on those exam tables.
How did you know that they were done? Steve, how did you know that they were done with the examination?
I probably didn't. I didn't know anything until I woke the next day.
Yeah, I don't remember either.
Wow, that's amazing. Do you guys know that, do you know if the ship was moving? Could you tell, was there any sense of movement? Could you tell that you were on a ship? Is it possible? The reason why I'm asking, how do you know that you were on a ship? Maybe you were in a room underground, right?
True. I suppose that's a possibility. I've never even contemplated that. I think it was totally assumption, being that we saw a ship above us. And, you know, it just would make sense, but we don't know.
Right.
You have a good point.
Yeah. Well, like I said, you didn't see any windows, so it's not like you could look out and see planet Earth, right? Or look down and see the desert. Am I right about that, Steve? Did you ever see one?
I'd say for sure, definitely right. There's nothing I could verify that we're in the sky. I guess it was just everything that led up to us, that sensation that we had. Probably one of the last memories was kind of ascending towards the ship in the sky.
Right.
That sensation of going up.
How are you guys, again, before we run out of time, thank you. Okay. Thank you from our family to your family. Thank you so much for coming forward. Very, very courageous. I know it's traumatic and I know it's heavy and you're recalling things that most of us just couldn't deal with. And it seems to me that you guys, your feet are on the ground. Okay. It seems to me. I could be wrong. You guys are looking at each other right now. If Jimmy only knew, right?
Right.
But thank you. How are you guys doing today?
I am emotionally exhausted. I'm done today.
But I would say, getting back to your question, Jimmy, you know, how we've dealt with it and gone on with our life. I think it's by, you know, trying to lead what we would say a normal life, doing the things that we think, raising our family, teaching our children good principles, good things, and trying to live the right
way. Our children have been so supportive. Always, but especially this week. They have been with us, and we couldn't do it without without their strength and support.
You can't. There's no way. And now, have you sat them down and said, hey, look, check this out. I don't think we're alone. Have you had that conversation with them?
Well, yes, we have. Most of them are quite aware that we're not alone. And a couple of them don't have all the details, but they understand we've been through something and that we believe that there's more to this world than most people realize.
I
think that's what it is. Jimmy, I'm sorry to interrupt there, but
yeah,
just
go ahead.
To say, you know, really, what is our hope in coming forward? Is it that hopefully others will maybe hear our voice and have courage to talk about it as well? I know it took us a long time, but, you know, I would be totally naive to think that we are alone in this universe. And I just know there's things that are unexplainable and that are out there, but they're very real and they're happening, and they're just not happening just to us. I know it's happened to others, and hopefully sharing our message will give someone else strength to share theirs, we hope.
Yeah, absolutely. The best thing you can always do is talk about it. And now this is what's funny. And when this happens, you guys have to come back and or call me and go, dude, mm-hmm. It happened today. One day, your kids are going to come home with some of their friends, and they're going to go, Mom and Dad, this is Bobby and Billy and Janet. Can you tell them the story? can you please? You know, and it's right. Going to happen. It hasn't happened yet, has it?
Well, we'll just give them your website and say, go listen.
It's going to happen. And I can't wait for that moment, because you guys are going to look at each other and go, okay, Church said this was going to happen, and I guess we got to sit down and have that conversation. And
I know we're kind of waiting for that can of worms to open.
It's going to. And again, thank you so much, Steve and Dawn Hess. Ron Felber, you're a hero, my brother. Thank you so much, Steve and
thank
Dawn. You guys keep rolling that rock uphill, okay? It's
all good.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Jimmy. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Steve and Dawn. Thanks very much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Jimmy.
There you go. Thank you so much. Steve and Dawn Hess, Ron Felber, the Mojave Incident Live, right here on Fade to Black. True heroes. Amazing story. They have come forward as 1989. This is 2016. They must feel great. Thank you so much. Takes a lot of courage. This is Fade to Black. Thank you to Steve and Dawn Hess and Ron Felber. Fade to Black's executive producers, Rita Camarion. Shows produced by Hilton J. Palm, Mark D. Kovar, LJ3, Renee, Mark Dunbar, Jonas. Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, Bob. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vitoe, and Mark D. Kovar. Fadey by Dale. Webmaster is Drew the Geek. Music, Doug Aldrich. Intro, Spaceboy, spaceboymusic.com. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Game Changer Network. Syndication is KGRA, The Planets. Tomorrow night, Fader Night, open lines all night long. This broadcast is owned and copyrighted 2016 by Fade to Black and the Game Changer Network. They cannot be rebroadcast, downloaded, copied, or used anywhere in the known universe without written permission from Fade to Black or the Game Changer Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Follow me on Twitter at JChurchRadio. I want everybody to be safe. Go back, Lee Tappy.